Here inside Dort Perry Stadium, one of the legendary venues around college football. Welcome to another big Saturday of action on ESPN. Rod Carey brings his Northern Illinois Huskies into tango with head coach Mike Jinks and the Bowling Green Falcons. So great to see you, everybody. Delighted you're here. Michael Regai, my partner, Gerard Cherry. If you like rock, sturdy, hard-hitting, aggressive defensive football, you come to the right place. This Northern Illinois Husky squad, they're perfect in the MAC, and they are one of the top defenses in the nation, Gerard. They rank in the top 10 in 8 different categories. And in Sutton Smith, their defensive end, they have one of the finest get-to-the-football defenders in all of college football.
Exactly. And when you have a defense that ranks in the top 10 nationally in a lot of categories, there has to be a ringleader. And that ringleader for Northern Illinois is Sutton Smith. He leads the nation. That's right, the nation in sacks and tackle for loss. So, again, if you are the Bowling Green Falcons, you have to pay close attention to Sutton Smith because he will get after you.
Yeah, so now if you're Mike Jicks at Bowling Green, you know, how do you find a way philosophically to move the football against this rock sturdy defense? Run game, and Bowling Green's got a good one. The last couple of weeks in tandem, Josh Cleveland and true freshman Andrew Clare, they've been dynamic. Can they do it again today?
They're going to have to. Cleveland and Clare, you like the alliteration, but they're going to have to be a sensation on the football today because, again, it's going to be up to them to carry the load with their ability to get past this defense for the Northern Illinois because they are so strong statistically. But Cleveland is a veteran. He knows the game. And Clare is a sensational freshman. And I'm very interested to see how his output takes place today, Michael, because, again, it's going to be up to this running game to get the job done.
Yeah, Mike Jinks feels very, very good about the capabilities of this run game. Northern Illinois, did they stay on collision course with Toledo in the MAC West? They want to. Bowling Green started to play better football. Got a win 2 weeks ago against Miami. You get set right here on ESPN. Maction coming your way. Northern Illinois and Bowling Green. We kick off next. I told you it's one of the legendary venues in college football. And when you get a day like this, just sun-kissed by the football gods, oh, baby, we're in for a lot of fun. As we get this 72-degree October afternoon. Well, that's Mike Jinks, the head football coach of the Bowling Green Falcons. Gerard, his second year in the program, 5 up at 14 down, has done a real nice job recruiting in his 2 years here on the campus at BG.
Yeah, and the true tale of that recruiting success is the fact that you have freshmen contributing to the effort. Though you're not winning, you do have freshmen doing their part to help rebuild this program.
Well, how about Rod Carey? Rod Carey is Northern Illinois through and through, folks. How good has he been? Yeah, well, how about 40-21 good? And you ready for this? This man right here, folks, is 28 up and 6 down. 28 wins, 6 losses in MAC games since he took over, Gerard, 5 years ago. That's a cool winning at an 83% clip in the MAC.
Yeah, that speaks of nothing but domination. The former offensive coordinator, now head coach, has done a great job with this program and sustaining that success. Had a fall off last season, but they can't think about last season. It's all about this year. As it typically is, Northern Illinois is in the running to win the MAC West.
Yep, 3 MAC West crowns and 2014 MAC championship win. And by the way, these two programs, Northern Illinois Bowling Green, 2013, 2014, 2015, they played about 90 miles up the road north here at Ford Field in Detroit. 3 straight MAC championship game battles between the two programs. Bowling Green won 2 of them.
Yeah, so the familiarity is certainly there, and the rivalry is there as well, because they are used to, as you said, Michael, playing for the big thing, and that is the championship of the MAC.
All right, we're about set to go. Settle back and enjoy it. As I said, just gloriously kissed by the football gods at 72 degrees. And game on here in Dort Perry Stadium as a driving that kick through the end zone. Jake Suter for the Bowling Green Falcons. So we're going to take a look at the redshirt freshman, Gerard Cherry. And oh, has Marcus Childers, the young man from Adairsville, Georgia. This is just his second start of the year, but oh, has he been special for Rod Carey.
Yeah, and what you like about Childers is the fact that he's that mobile quarterback that you find in the Northern Illinois offense and that he can move around, make things happen. He has the wiggle. One of the concerns that they have is the accuracy, but that will improve because you're dealing with, again, a young player who's going to find his way eventually.
on this very first snap. Rod Carey is going to go empty. Five wide receivers looking to spread this Bowling Green defense out. Childers will deliver that quick strike, and he's on time to G.J. Brown. Brown's got a quick 11. That's a first down. That simple pitch and catch, Gerard Carey, sitting in the zone.
Exactly, and that's what we call allowing the quarterback to get a rhythm, to find that sense of timing so that he can get his confidence up. You like those type of play calls when you're dealing with an experienced quarterback.
Now they're going without Jordan Huff, their number one tailback today. Childers will start out 2 for 2 as he just zips that strike near the midfield stripe to Spencer Tears, who made that grab. And Gerard, this is the thing about Childers, young guy getting his first opportunity to play. He's hitting 64% of his throws in his first FBS experience as a QB.
Yeah, and what you appreciate about this particular pass play is that he diagnoses the hole in the defense. And if the Bowling Green Falcons are not going to press and play zone, he can exploit that all day.
A veteran offensive line, first time to the ground game today, and that carry for Northern Illinois was Tommy Mister. Mister wears number 26. He's a redshirt junior out of Chicago, out of that St. Rita program in the city. So give him a couple. Let's call it second down and 8 as we're just underway here at Doit Perry Stadium. Crossover Mac West battle today. Northern Illinois from the Mac West and Bowling Green from the East. Now off that jet sweep look, it'll be Childers to carry the football. And Gerard, this Bowling Green front seven, they're getting better and better and pinching down there and coming up with some plays.
And so far on this particular drive, the run defense has been present. It's the issue with the zone coverage on the defensive end that's been an issue and why Northern Illinois has had success thus far driving down the football field.
And it was Nate Locke that was in on that stop. You'll see a lot of the Mike linebacker with a 4-point GPA today. Nate Locke, who wears number 27. Childers on 3rd and 7. Going to pull the football down. Marcus Childers, he got there. First down with that tough, tough quarterback carry to the 40-yard line on 3rd and 7.
And that is the luxury of having a mobile quarterback. In that, if there's nothing down the field, as you see right here, Childers is back there. The time is being provided for him, but there's no one open. So what do? You tuck it and run and do what you can to pick up positive yards for the first down. And that's exactly what Childers did.
So this Bowling Green defense is Mike Jinksfeld to be the case, being tested for zone read run. And that's Tommy Mister. It's this power football out of the zone read. Give him 7 following the blocks of the right side of that offensive line. Nathan Velos, the right guard, and the true freshman, Gerard, Isaac Hahn, the right tackle. And going quickly and put it in the hands of D.J. Brown. D.J. Brown on that tempo series is going to come up real close to picking up that first down at the 30-yard line.
And that's exactly what it is, a tempo series, in that you're not giving the defense an opportunity to recover. You have a nice balance of running pass taking place, but the speed and the uptick of the game is causing Bowling Green right now to be under duress because they simply can't gather their whereabouts because they're getting pushed up and down the football field.
They're going without Jordan Huff today, by the way. We should mention their number one running back banged up last week and not able to go. Stay on the ground game. Tommy Mister has broke free, and see you later. Touchdown, Northern Illinois. Tommy Mister to the house.
And we talk about Bowling Green being under duress. Perfect example right here. You get a combination of run and pass, and right here with the running game, Mister shows you that he is the man on this particular run by going barely untouched down the football field for the score.
Trot, how about one of the best left tackles of the business, the Outland Trophy candidate, Max Sharping there, running behind Sharping to the house from Mister.
Yeah, that shows you why he's a candidate, because of that hole provided for Mister for the score.
Adding the PAT is Christian Hagen. That's perfect, as was this first drive of the afternoon. Tommy Mister, the young man from Chicagoland, into the end zone. Northern Illinois with a quick 7-0 lead. Well, when you have one of the absolutely most aggressive and sturdy defenses in college football, you got a light on when your offensive football team goes 75 yards and puts seven on the board. I think Rod Carey likes that.
Especially on the opening drive. When you go back to last week, you were only able to muster 14 points, and you come out with that type of production on the offensive end, that definitely bodes well for the Huskies, and the defense has to be fired up because they're seeing their offense hold up their end of the bargain.
So the Bowling Green Falcons to get their hands on the football for the first time. And on this return, this is the outstanding freshman Andrew Clair. Boy, we're going to tell you a lot about this young man today to the 29-yard line. So with 11:42 left in this first quarter, and we'll keep setting down in distance for you, score the game, time of the game, and I'll give you the radio effect a little bit because as we work on some technical issues with the opportunity for you to see all that. So we'll take care of that for you. 7-0 Northern Illinois. And Gerard, that young man right there is James Morgan. He's a redshirt sophomore out of Green Bay, Wisconsin. And again, the run game, though, right now could be the key. Speaking of the run game, this is Josh Cleveland that got to the edge. Simple zone read stuff, and Cleveland turned the corner, Gerard.
And you see Josh is running with the limp, but on that particular run, he got to the outside. If you are in a situation where you do not protect the boundary, Cleveland will make you pay for that every day and all day.
Well, Cleveland got 12 and stay with the run game. And that is Andrew Clair. Now, you're going to see a heavy, heavy dose. So, Gerard, let's set this. Josh Cleveland is the senior out of Austin, Texas. Cleveland with close to 500 yards on the year and a couple touchdowns. But this Andrew Clair, true freshman out of St. Louis, Missouri, the last 2 weeks he's had 121 yards against Miami and 148 more last week. As Morgan will throw that strike as he delivers his first throw of the afternoon. That's Janarvis Pugh, the young man from Hollywood, Florida, on the catch.
That's what we call a pro throw because he literally threw to the other side of the football field on a deep out, and it was an accurate pass, so that has to do very much for the confidence of Morgan.
Now going to run that jet sweep. And nowhere to go is coming up to make that hit. For the Northern Illinois Huskies is Jawan Johnson. Jawan Johnson had a 25-yard pick six to get this defense rolling in that big win against Big Ten Nebraska in September.
And very interesting call because we mentioned it in the opening that Northern Illinois leads the country in tackles for loss, is one of the statistical leaders in tackles for loss. So you might not want to employ those type of plays against this defense.
That was for a minus nine. So now Bowling Green going to try to go back to that straight power run game. And just not much there for the senior Josh Cleveland. I want you to keep an eye on number 15, who featured in our open, Sutton Smith, defensive end for Northern Illinois. MAC player of the week, 3 sacks and 4 tackles for loss against Kent State, one of the best in the business. But, boy, he's got a lot of help there. There's a good look at Sutton Smith.
Yes, you saw it on the 2 plays ago in that reverse where the defense was at home, did what they were called to do in the defense, and a positive play took place for them.
Well, James Morgan, though, coming out sharp delivering that throw as he was able to hook up early with Matthew Wilcox. Wilcox, also a true freshman. So Andrew Clair and Matthew Wilcox, both true frosh delivering.
Yeah, and entering the game, the issue with Morgan was accuracy. But so far on 2 plays, though he did not pick up the first down, as far as the passes are concerned, he did throw accurate balls.
That'll bring on one of the largest punters. And, folks, this is one of the finest punters in the nation. This is an All-American here, the Bowling Green career leader in punt yardage and also a total yardage on punts, Joseph Davidson, just down I-75. You see he'll try to get that tail to turn over and put it down inside the 1-yard line. And Josh Joseph Davidson has done it right there. Folks, he could finish as high as 4th in the NCAA history with a career punting average. Joseph Davidson of Bowling Green. 7-0 Northern Illinois with the lead. Second opportunity for the Huskies with the football next. Yeah, how about Joseph Davidson, huh? Ray Guy watch list. Our ESPN buddy Phil Steele, he's a first-team All-MAC performer, and Steele's assessment this year showed you why right there. Roddy put that down at the 1-yard line.
And that's how you flip the field, Michael. Excellent kick, great composure, and it's rare that you highlight a punt, but when you do something of that magnitude on a regular basis, you do deserve to get called out and your name in the paper. And he's an excellent kicker with a great chance on the next level.
First time Northern Illinois and their redshirt Frost quarterback Marcus Childers had the football. They went 75 yards and put seven on the board. Now going to go to the ground game, and Bowling Green's front seven is there to stack that up. Tommy Mister got belted by Nate Locke. Hey, Gerard, this guy's got a 4-point GPA, man, something that you and I could never have dreamed of in our days.
Yeah, that speaks well of him, because one thing to represent the football field but also do it academically as well speaks very highly of the young man in Locke.
Yeah, Childers out of the end zone was getting pressure and just got to throw the football away, and that was Nate Locke, that Mike linebacker, put pressure on. And partner, by the way, if you want to say to me, hey, man, speak for yourself about academic prowess, I can understand. Now, you might have been a 3-8, 3-9 guy.
Right? More like a 3-4, 3-5.
Well, Marcus Childers, he's been not only doing the job in the club, but how about this young man again? He's out of Adairsville, Georgia, Adairsville High School, redshirt freshman, and he took the job from the veteran Daniel Santa Catarina here 2 games ago, and this is Childers. Nothing there on third down. Hey, that Bowling Green defense, they said, you know what? You might have went 75 on us right out of the gate, but we're going to give our offensive football back. Nice job by Bowling Green's team.
Exactly. That's how you respond. You have a situation where they drive right down the football field on you, but you have a chance to pin them down and get great field position for your offense. And how do you respond with a 3-and-out situation? That speaks of being resilient and not giving up, because had Northern Illinois marched down the football field, that would not have boded well for the Falcons.
All right, here's Matt Ferentz now. This line drive punt's going to settle down about the 40-yard line. And Spencer Tears is telling his Bowling Green mates to stay away from that. All right, Gerard Cherry, after the Ferentz punt, he did not get that to turn over the way he wanted. Short field now for Mike Jink's offense.
Yes, and I like the way Morgan's been throwing the football. You've had some success running the ball, but hey, give Morgan a chance, because so far he's shown that he can throw it in tight spaces, and his arm is working very accurately.
Yeah, folks, as you look at James Morgan, remember now, this is a Bowling Green program that, look, now, they 3 years in a row, 3 years in a row, 2013, 14, and 15, went to the MAC championship game, as James Morgan will keep the football on that straight quarterback keep. Give Morgan four, where he got crunched at the 35. But, Gerard, my point is 3 years in a row, and that was Dino Babers, Dave Clawson first, and Dino Babers, Wake Forest, Syracuse. This program was the best in the MAC East. 3 years in a row, won 2 MAC championship games. As that is the running back, the senior, Josh Cleveland, very close to moving the sticks. They wanted to run the ball today, Jerome.
And that makes all the sense in the world when you're facing one of the top defenses in the land, especially when it calls for getting off to the quarterback.
Boy, they went tempo there, and Josh Cleveland got met by, there's our man that we featured in the open, Sutton Smith. Now, Gerard, fourth and real short, going to line up and run it. First down for the big fella. That's a 240-pound quarterback, James Morgan. How about Mike Jinks going tempo there with run game?
I like the call by Coach Jinks in that you want to show your defense and the offense that, hey, we got faith in you and that we're going to keep you off the field from a defensive standpoint and get after Northern Illinois, because there's no reason to show fear. You're very familiar with this football team. Yes, you respect what they're doing on the defensive end, but when you make plays like that, that's also sending a message that, hey, we've come to play today and we are going to take our chances.
Now, how about that? Deliverance of, you know, some rule situation from referee Tim O'Day. So he's going. Mike Jinks wants to know what? Whoa, what? Why isn't that snap that we just picked up the first down on fourth down valid?
Yeah, in essence, what the referee is saying is that the chain game was not set. And because it was not set, you cannot snap the football. It looks to me as if it is set.
Well, so it wasn't readied for play
right by
the gentleman with the white hat, Tim O'Day. Now, Mike Jinks, though, now still 4.5 yards, folks, but that just took a first down off the board. Let's see. Line up out of the eye. Morgan going to give the football. He went to the big fella in the offense, Donovan Wilson, and Northern Illinois is saying they just got to stop. They just got to stop. as it was Leonard Skedebo, the tight end that ran at Girard. How about this change of events?
And the key to it all is penetration on the part of Northern Illinois' defense. You like the quick hitting run by the fullback. At the same time, if you have no push up front, you will not get that first down. And Coach Jinx is obviously upset about the previous call in which he lost the first down.
Well, I know our producer Jeff Bentley and director Mark Isofano, two of the best in the business. They're running the show. They'll mark that for us here. This Bowling Green possession, because again, Bowling Green just had a fourth down conversion on a first down taken off the board. Going to bring the gadgets out now for Christian Blake in Northern Illinois. Blake showing you his hops, his lively legs there as they brought that gadget play out and reversed it to Christian Blake, the senior out of Fort Lauderdale, Florida.
And what you appreciate about the play call is you like to run gadget plays or take shots after situations in which the defense is probably sinking their heads and saying to themselves, not fair, not fair, and you try to catch them off guard. But, again, didn't give up too big of a play. Definitely got positive yards, however.
Childers ran that speed option, and he got snowed on over there as coming up to make that hit for the Bowling Green Falcons, making that stop and wearing that that number 8. For Bowling Green coming up.
Elijah Cunningham.
Yep, Elijah made that hit.
Check that. David Kunlowski.
Yeah, the defensive end. Number was right, but remember, I said double numbers, offense, defense.
Get you every time.
David Kunlowski making that stop. He's a defensive end. But we're inside the 6-minute mark. On a 3rd and 3, Childers. Off that influence jet sweep and then pulled the football down and rolled down to the 31-yard line. That's 32 yards for Marcus Childers.
And watch the play fake. An excellent read on the part of Childers and then shows you the ability to get down the football field to the 2nd and 3rd level to pick up more positive yards. But that play was all predicated on the fact that he did an excellent job of selling the initial fake.
Yeah, influencing the defense. Did a terrific job of it off that that fly sweep look. Again off play action. That misdirect now screen, and they put it in the hands, did Northern Illinois. They put it in the hands of, that's Marcus Jones. Jones is a redshirt sophomore. Again, no Jordan Huff today. The number one running back for Northern Illinois dinged up, didn't make the trip.
Yeah, but right now, to the credit of the running back corps, you're not missing the production of Jordan Huff.
Childers fires the out right on time and made that strong throw and was able to connect to Chad Beebe. Remember that name? Is Daddy Don
yes.
Beebe? You played against him,
yeah,
didn't you?
Very similar build as well if you watch these pass and catch connects between Childers and Beebe. Nothing but a simple out route, but effective because it picks up the first down. That's such a hard route to cover nowadays because they have what's called an option route, and that if defender is playing too much on inside, you have the option to go outside.
Childers now going to put it up on first down. Oh, look at that time. Came down underneath. That throw is caught by Spencer Tears. Tears finally got belted inside the 10-yard line. It looks like Tears is down as he took a pretty strong shot as he wanted to turn the corner there.
And we have Childers dropping back, and he's looking through and finds Tears on the crossing route. Give credit to the offensive line for providing that much time to allow a receiver to literally come across the field. As you see at the tail end of that play, he absorbed the turf as well as the weight and impact of a defender falling on top of him.
And Nate Locke was there to provide the clinching hit as the Northern Illinois athletic crew take a look at Spencer Tears.
And give credit to Childers because on those type of pass plays, that's his 3rd and 4th option. So to have the patience as a young quarterback to let the route develop and not force issue and take off running because we know he has the ability to do just that. And you see right here at the tail end, as he falls down right into the turf, he gets drilled into there, and that's painful to say the least.
So Tears being looked at. Girard, to your point you make, I think it's an excellent point because as that play started to unfold, Childers was looking end zone.
Yes.
He was looking to take that shot. He came off what looked like to be a wheel route, came back to the middle, and then checked down to that shallow cross.
Yeah, that's what you call progression. That's what you want to see out of your young quarterback. When you start realizing that there are different facets of the route tree and that you're able to incorporate and read that and allow it to develop and be patient, that speaks well of your development and your maturation as a quarterback.
Now he's playing for the first time here as Spencer Tears now is on his feet, which is a good sign. But, Gerard, does that speak to you a lot of film study and a lot of really grasping the mechanics of this offense for a redshirt freshman?
It certainly does. And you go back to last week, there was issues with accuracy. But one of the things that you always want to see is how do you bounce back the following week? And you have to be very encouraged with your coach, Carey, of what you've seen thus far from your young quarterback in that he's done the run game very well and this decision-making, the passing, has been awesome as the Jackson as well.
First a goal from the 8. Good stop from the Bowling Green Falcons there. That's Fred Garth, the rover. We'll see Garth. He wears number 4. Rangy 190-pounder out of Mississippi. Watch him make this hit.
Yeah, and the Bowling Green Falcons said, we're not falling for the banana and tailpipe with the jet sweep again. We're going to watch you, Chills, because you are a dangerous threat. It's a great job of staying home on the part of the Falcons.
So Childers only got 1. Second and goal now from the 7-yard line. Northern Illinois trying to add to their 7-0 lead. Childers on that throwback, standing all by himself to make the touchdown grab is Shane Wyman, one of the finest tight ends in the country. Gerard Cherry, I'll just put it out there in general. I love off play action, the throwback to the tight end in the red zone, buddy.
It's such a beautiful play because you're thinking to yourself, misdirection, this guy's blocking me, no one takes responsibility for him. And one of the things you have to know coming to this game is that Wyman is the leading tight end touchdown receiver for this program's history, so you have to pay attention to him. But that is an excellent play, call and design, because, again, the whole effort an issue is fooling the defense to think that he's part of the blocking scheme when actually he's going to go out for a pass.
Well, this Northern Illinois offense is Christian Hagan will have the PAT. Shane Wyman, he's one of the best in the business, folks. Where's that number 35? He's caught a touchdown pass from every one of the last 5 Northern Illinois quarterbacks going back 3 years now. 14-0. Huskies playing well on the road in Bowling Green.
All ESPN coverage is streaming live on the ESPN app. Download now and take ESPN everywhere.
It's been a pretty strong first 11 and a half minutes for Rod Carey and his perennial Mac West titleist, the Northern Illinois Huskies. I'm Michael Rega, my partner Gerard Cherry, Northern Illinois, after the Marcus Childers touchdown throw to that terrific tight end Shane Wyman has a 14-0 lead. And this is the true freshman sensation, Andrew Clare, on the Bowling Green return. Bad return to the 24-yard line, and that's where Bowling Green will start this offensive thrust. Keep an eye on number 32 today, folks. He's a good one. Gerard, let's look in that Bowling Green offensive huddle, partner. I'm going to give you an assignment. Teal Redding, the top receiver on this football team. He's got his helmet in his hand. He's been banged up, but he hasn't been on the football field as of yet.
Yeah, and that does not speak well for the cause for the Bowling Green Falcons because he's one of their leading receivers. And if you can't get or expect production out of him today, it's going to be a struggle in its own right. And as you said, Michael, he's still not participating.
Yeah, 5th-year senior, young man out of Warren, Michigan, Michigan Collegiate High School in the Motor City of Detroit area. Morgan, he got a big break there because he just almost gift-wrapped that pick as it was broken up by McKelty Williams. And Williams probably kicking himself, Gerard.
Yeah, when he sees it on film tomorrow, he'll want to do more than kick himself, and Morgan's going to have to be more patient. Though you're down 14-0, don't force the issue.
And this is Andrew Clare. Look at this true freshman bounced outside that stack and turned no gain into 7 yards to bring up 3rd down and short. All right, what do you think, partner? First glance, early blush at Andrew Clare.
Very impressive. This run speaks to that. There's nothing to gain here. Dead to rights, but guess what? He has the ability to stay alive and make something out of nothing. Very composed running, and you like the presence that this young freshman has.
And Bowling Green pick up 3rd and 2. They were snuffed on a 4th and a half yard. Blitz coming. Morgan will check down. Came into that underneath seam, delivered a strike First down to Scotty Miller, the first team All-MAC performer from a year ago. That's one of the best slot receivers in the MAC, folks.
It's always great to have a security blanket like Scott Miller on the offensive side playing that slot role, because he gets the weaknesses of the defense and where he can find those holes.
Bowling Green will move the chain. Look at that spin cycle move. What is that? Is that B in Madden coming out of the spin mode like that?
That's B and X. That's how you
both
do it.
Right.
And watch this right here. That's the sign that you are a special talent when you're able to, from your peripheral vision, make that type of spin and still keep your balance and pick up positive yards. Very excited to watch Claire as he runs the football with authority.
Well, he's got the wow factor. Look at him there, too. Now, he's only about a buck 90, but did you see that shot he took from Mike linebacker Alex Schwab? Schwab didn't get him on the ground right away, another yard after contact.
Another sign of a quality back. What do you do once you meet contact? Can you go forward? And right there, that's exactly what Claire did to get the first down. Just a freshman.
Now Morgan off play action will fire the out. That is hauled in, making that grab and inside the 20-yard line for Bowling Green. Making that catch was Jalen Ember. Making that grab was Daedrin Guyton. Guyton made that grab inside the 20 to the 18-yard line.
Yeah, and if the defensive back is going to play that far off of you, you make those curl route decisions all day, every day. So great pickup on the part of Morgan and Guyton for receiving the football and knowing what to do once he caught it.
Bowling Green's going to get a timeout.
Bowling Green is taking their first timeout of the half.
Partner,
this
remember
will be a 30-second team timeout.
We had Chuck Martin's Miami Redhawks a couple weeks ago, and that size of that, what, James Gardner, number 81 for Miami. This young fella, Daedrin Guyton, he's a junior out of Texas, 6'5", about 205 pounds, and showed that, you talk about an outside threat, outside the numbers with size, maybe this is going to be Bowling Green's guy.
Yeah, and what that speaks to is now you're in the red zone. Do you take that shot with the fade route because you have the size mismatch with Guyton versus the cornerback for Northern Illinois? Now, they do have some stellar defenders on that side of the ball.
Boy, don't they.
Especially speak of Lurie.
Shawan Lurie, folks. He wears number 19. And when we were talking to Rod Carey this week, remember the All-American Jimmy Ward from a few years ago that was a first-round draft pick of the San Francisco 49ers? Lurie is kind of in that mold. Well, after the Guyton catch, Morgan will fire the out. Well, James Morgan has started hot today as he catches that quick out route to Janarvis Pugh. Pugh's got size as well, 6'2". His second catch, and Bowling Green's going quickly.
As you see, Pugh runs a curl route. Defender is going to play 10-plus yards off and simply sit down and pick up the first down.
On second and two, now off that that play fake. With running back Josh Cleveland, Morgan kept the football. He got knocked down. Well, this Northern Illinois defense, folks, we'll go through it here. They are in the top 12 in 8 different defensive categories on the year. They only give up 16 points a game. They gave up 30 a game a year ago when it went 5-7.
So we call turning things around.
No flag. Morgan taking a shot in zone. It is caught. Touchdown, Bowling Green, making that grab, Quinton Morris. Morris made the catch, and Morgan delivered a dart for the quick six for Bowling Green.
See, Morgan's in the pocket, comfortable, and throws it through a tight window to Morgan for the TD. Very impressed so far what I've seen from the passing of Josh Morgan today.
Jake Suter to add that PAT. Suter's one of the best in the MAC. Came after that touchdown throw. The M&M gang as James Morgan hit freshman Quinton Morris, another true freshman that Mike Jinks has recruited and now has him on the football field as just babies at 18 years of age.
And they may have gotten away with legal procedure, as you see the tackle kicks back, but that doesn't bother Morgan. James says, you know what, I'm still going to deliver this pass through a tight window. And if you coach Jinx, you're saying to yourself, my quarterback has come to play today, because thus far in this game, James Morgan has been on fire.
That's a real good drive there from the Bowling Green Falcons. 76-yard drive, a lot of Andrew Clare, and Morgan went 4 for 4 on the drive, hit Miller, course, hit that big out as well to Datron Guyton, and then the touchdown throw.
Right, and the ability to answer. You're down 14-0. You drive down the football field. Because if you don't do that, who's to say how your defense is going to respond in return? Do they quit? Do they say we have no chance in this football game? But by doing that, you keep the game in the balance. So you have to be very encouraged with Mike Jinks and company out of the play of what you're getting out of Morgan in the offense so far.
No question about that. So it's got to make Bowling Green feel good. As it hadn't been a whole lot of that put up on Northern Illinois this year, as we have raved, and rightfully so, about their defensive specialty on this football team. This boot going through the back of the end zone. And again, Marcus Childers, the Northern Illinois quarterback, and the Huskies are going to start from their 25-yard line. But, Gerard, they've seen that to what was 14-0 lead now, with only 38 ticks left in the first quarter, sliced in half after that BG touchdown drive.
Yeah, and the key is to match that level of intensity and production that you saw out of Bowling Green if you're Childers and company, because you're saying to yourself, let's march down this football field. We've had our success. We've seen the up-tempo. We've seen the combination of run and pass, and they've had nothing but success, hence the score.
Yeah, that's got to be great for James Morgan's confidence, as we said. Now this is Tommy Mister. That's out of that zone read look. They run a lot of one back, four wide receivers. And, if Wyman's on the football field, Gerard, so it's 11 personnel. You could explain that, partner.
Yes, and it's very simple. You have one running back, you have one tight end, and
one,
you have multiple receivers, hence the 11.
See,
now,
11.
If you have two running backs and one tight end, we call that 21 personnel.
Beautiful, partner. Good stuff. A lot of times we see now, and, back in the days when we were playing, it wasn't, a lot of times you'll see 10 personnel, right?
Yes.
A lot of, so we'll get into that more. Just our football, offensive football tutorial presented by Gerard Cherry. Sights and sounds of a big MAC crossover battle. MAC West, Northern Illinois. MAC East, Bowling Green. Good one going on. 14-7, Northern Illinois, second quarter next. Boy, does this bring back memories to Bowling Green Falcon football fans. This is the 1992 Bowl Championship squad here for the Mets. That's Gary Blackney right there, that distinguished-looking gentleman right in the middle with all of his. Gerard, that's 25 years ago, partner.
And what you find about those reunions is that you may have not spoken to someone for over a decade, and you fit right back in place to once you were together on a regular basis.
How about that? Marcus Childers going to load it up. It was almost picked off. He was looking for Christian Blake. But how about that excellent coverage out of the secondary? Montrey Gregory right there, Gerard, the young man from Baltimore, Maryland on the coverage.
And Montrey does an exceptional job of, one, pushing Blake off the spot, but then convert himself to become the receiver to try to make a play on the football.
So how about that? After the Bowling Green touchdown, head coach Rod Carey of Northern Illinois said, let's load up and take a shot here. Childers again to put it up. Triggering the out. BB made the grab. Chad BB. BB's got a quick 13, and that's a first down as BB going to work on the Bowling Green corners.
Well, BB did a sensational job of selling a deep route, but then breaking it to a deep out.
Second catch for Chad BB. So just underway in the second quarter. Great to have you along. Michael Regeye, Gerard Cherry, all of our crew. That straight quarterback run from Marcus Childers, and he got popped after he got three. 15, Kyle Jr. made that hit. Gerard, that name Kyle Jr. How about EJ Jr., the former Alabama great, NFL great, his son, Kyle Jr.?
That's right. One of our impact players. One of the things you like about Kyle's game is that he is forceful in the middle, and he's just a sophomore and having an impact already for Mike Jean's squad.
Yep, they really like him because he's been doing a terrific job. That football should have been caught. Christian Blake knows that. I think everybody in Northern Illinois Husky land knows that. Blake, maybe, was he taking a peek, Gerard, as it looked like he was looking at Brandon Harris, who is a tough-witty linebacker.
Yeah, Brandon Harris, I'm going to make you pay for it. As you see, Blake lines up, makes the turn, but, again, he sees Big 19 running towards him. And I understand the pain that's potentially there for you. That will cause you to drop the football when you know a hitter like that is coming your way.
Real strong hitter. Now this is 3rd and 7. Childers on the move. BB, just like his daddy, made that tough grab. And again, Don Beebe, the former possession receiver in the NFL, as his son Chad just made his 3rd catch, 2nd on this drive, 1st down Northern Illinois.
And look at the precision of the route and how he breaks it off. There's no wasted motion or movement. It's right there on the spot where he needs to turn to catch the football. That's a sign that, again, he's getting tutorial from a pro.
Yeah, I was just going to say, you was an NFL DB. How many times do you think he watched his daddy do that as he was a little fella growing up? Off play action, wheel route. Should have been a touchdown. Would have been a touchdown. Marcus Jones forgot to secure the football. That wheel route was completely clean, Gerard.
And another example of the beauty of a misdirection play, and that no one picks up Jones out of the backfield. He is free, and the problem with that is he's thinking, I have a touchdown, but you have to secure and catch the football before you do anything. And he's going to kick himself tomorrow.
Evergreen Park, Illinois, Marcus Jones, redshirt sophomore, had 6. Now Childers going to take a shot. Look at it, BB. And threw that football out of bounds. Gerard, you as a defensive back, I see so much and we talk about a lot of times, receivers, do they not have to start that route though more on the numbers? It seems sometimes they run themselves out of bounds with not much of a pocket for the quarterback to throw the football.
Excellent point, Michael, and that's exactly what you have to do. You have to still provide that space on the sideline. You got to give yourself at least 2 yards to give the quarterback something to work with, and right there, maybe do the reroute. You have a situation where BB was out of position due to his alignment.
Well, let's see on 3rd and 10. Childers will keep the football. Marcus Childers, excellent spin move. He's going to come up about a yard shy of the first down as Childers was trying to go to work there. Montre Gregory was in on the stop, and we've got an injured Bowling Green Falcon as well. Get a look at that. I think that that Bowling Green defender is Malik Brown, a fifth-year senior. It is Malik Brown out of Palm Beach, Florida, that's being attended to. All right, while Malik Brown gets attended to, we'll step aside. 14-7 Northern Illinois when we get back. All the excitement, all the color, all the what's better than college football? Nothing is better than college football. Hope you're enjoying it here on ESPN. Michael Reggett, Gerard Cherry, our producer Jeff Bentley, director Mark Isofano. The boys are in fine fashion along with all of our crew and ladies too. Kudos to each and every one of them. This is 4th and 1. Childers in trouble. Got flushed. Bowling Green's got to stop and going to take possession of the football. They got to stop on 4th and 1. Mike linebacker Nate Locke coming up and making the clinching hit on Childers.
Well, we already know based on his academic prowess that Nate Locke's a smart, heady football player. But right here you see Childers is in a spot where the indecision costs him. You got to be decisive in those type of spots where you're just going to run, commit to it, and not try to wait too long for things to happen, because at some point, as you saw take place there, the defense is going to collapse on you.
So after the touchdown drive, now Nate Locke with a 4th. Now both clubs have got a 4th down stop now with the opponent driving in their territory. Now run that toss sweep. How about that defensive play? Is coming down to take Josh Cleveland down for Northern Illinois was Josh Corcoran. Corcoran and his defensive coordinator, Gerard, this week, D coordinator Kevin Kane said he can handle a variety of assignments and technique. They love Corcoran as we wait on
the flag. Personal foul, block below the waist, offense number 6. 15-yard penalty, 1st down.
And Gerard, what we liked about that, you know, Sutton Smith, of course, Corcoran's opposite number on the defensive end side, getting all the rave reviews, as he should. He leads the nation in sacks and tackles for loss. But what did defensive coordinator Kevin Kane tell us? Hey, don't forget about Josh Corcoran now. Young man on the other side can set that edge wonderfully, means a lot to our defense.
It certainly does. And when you are of the ability to run down Cleveland from the back as a defensive end, that speaks very well of your talent and your ability. That cannot go unnoticed. It's worth a couple mentions.
Well, after that penalty, that's going to bring up 1st and 25 now for James Morgan. Morgan going to trigger it a deep out, and he got picked off. It was intercepted as stepping in to make that INT was Trayshawn Foster. Gerard, this secondary, their Bullhawks. Northern Illinois destroyed Nebraska from the Big Ten with their ability to come up with big turnovers.
And it's all predicated on the defensive line applying the pressure. And when you have the ability to apply the four-man rush and get to the quarterback just with the four guys you have up front, and in the case we're here, Morgan staring down his receiver, you have to look off the safety, because if you don't, things like that will occur often. You have to give a look and not allow free safety middle football field to see where you're going with the football.
So for James Morgan, throwing that INT there, and listen, his decision-making had been terrific today.
And that was more of an issue, Michael, of just technique, in that when you go to your drop-back pass, you cannot stare down a receiver. You have to look off the defender, because not that's the job of the safety, to track you and follow where the football is going.
Absolutely. Now, how does Bowling Green handle the sudden change? Childers, he got knifed down. He got knifed down, and coming up to make that stop out of the secondary for Bowling Green. Making that hit was Montre Gregory again from the corner. And what is the first thing that Mike Jenks told us? He said, he's very candid on our call. He said, Gerard, Michael, we need James Morgan to see the field and anticipate better pre-snap. Well, look at the Bowling Green defense with a football on the ground. As running back Tommy Mister got stuck. And again, coming up to make a part. Part of that hit was David Kanawalski. Kanawalski wears number 8. This is third down now and 12 as Bowling Green's D. Again, they seem to have, after the touchdown, they seem to have catched kind of a life themselves, Gerard.
Right, and instead of lowering their heads and tucking their tails, they're playing very fired up, aggressive football.
Third and 12. Childers going to take a shot. It was almost picked off. He was looking for his wide receiver as he wanted to find Spencer Tears. Tears was in double coverage, though. That was Clint Stevens. There's Stevens, the veteran, the redshirt junior. Got a hand on that, looked like.
And this is exactly how you play down the field in the fade route by Stevens, in that you look back for the ball and you compete for it as well, so you don't bail out the receiver with the referee throwing a pass interference call on those type of plays. Because, again, if you don't look back, if you don't make a play, chances are they will call the P.I.
So Marcus Childers and the Northern Illinois offense not able to take advantage of the IA to the PAT. And this punt is going to come up very short. And on that Bowling Green fair catch was Marcus Milton off the punt from Matt Ferentz. All right, Rod and I are going to discuss James Morgan when we get back. 14-7 Northern Illinois. Mike Jenks, second-year head coach of his Bowling Green Falcon football squad. They got to win 2 weeks ago in Miami. All right, James Morgan, we just discussed it. He's just throwing the INT, Gerard. Defense got him the football right back. Now Mike Jenks, as you're going to go with that first down carry with this dazzling freshman. Look at the move from Andrew Clare. Finally run out of bounds at the 43-yard line. That's 30 yards at a first down. Oh, does this young man have maybe a late flag with a face mask on the end of it? Gerard, how big of a future does this 18-year-old true freshman have in this program?
It's extremely bright, because this is the third time today we've seen his ability to get not to the first and second level, but to the third level with his ability to make a guy miss in the open field. And that's a great sign. And it may be negated because of that one grab right there to the face mask.
Tim O'Day's talking about it. Let's see.
Personal foul, face mask, offense, number 32, 15-yard penalty, first down.
Gerard, the young man had a 30-yard gain right there. Now it's going to be marked back from the spot of the foul.
And obviously you are about protecting the players, and it is a face mask. There's a denying that, but you hate to see a great run like that negated because of the tail end of the play.
That was a veteran linebacker, Jawan Johnson, as we mentioned, the young man from East St. Louis, Illinois. Real good linebacker who had a pick six against Tanner Lee in Nebraska a few weeks back. Now this is Josh Cleveland, and look at the swarm to the football of this defense of Northern Illinois as they were all over that. Bobby Jones, the opposite number of Juwan Johnson, who wears number six at outside linebacker.
And when you're in defensive meetings, you highlight this type of effort, and it was all led again by Sutton Smith and his ability to get penetration in the backfield to force Cleveland to take a wider angle and not get to the line of scrimmage.
Morgan going to load it up deep, and he got picked off again. Not a good decision from James Morgan. It was intercepted out of that Northern Illinois secondary by Jackson Abresh, who made the pick. Picks on back-to-back possessions, late flag coming out. Decisions, Gerard Cherry, from quarterbacks.
Decisions, as well as technique and just understanding where ball placement should be. You have to put air on that football, and you also have to throw it outside. You do not throw a pass route inside, especially when you have a quarter or a half safety, because you're essentially throwing it directly to the defender. And Mike Jinks is telling them right now, you have to do a better job of ball location, as well as figuring out what the defense is doing pre- and post-snap, because you have a situation there where you should have read cover two or a quarter.
After the play,
Northern Illinois, number 19, 15-yard penalty, first down. That is number 19's first unsportsmanlike conduct foul of the game.
That's the All-American candidate, Shawan Lurie, who has 14 career interceptions. They've been staying away from him today. Gerard, Mike Jinks, first thing he said as we look at James Morgan, he told us both, I need James, and I've told him, I need you to make improvements with your reads. See the field. See the defensive alignment pre-snap.
Right.
The last two possessions have just those points Mike Jinks made to us have just come home to roost.
They certainly have, and it's also what we call the fine nuances of playing quarterback, in that you cannot stare down your receiver. You have to give another look as far as looking off the safety, pretending like you're going somewhere else to football, then coming back to that area. And on two occasions, he has not done that, and that has led to interceptions.
Tommy Mister on that first down call out of the zone read, as Bowling Green now got to go back on defense and try to keep getting stops. Aaron Banks, 50-year senior outside linebacker, on the stop. Mister got four, second and six. See how the Bowling Green defense responds if they can dig Morgan out of it. Now off that check down, Childers will go to his big tight end as he put it in the hands of the touchdown maker, Shane Wyman. That is going to get Wyman inside the 40 to about the 38. Going to come up third and short. Call it a long one here.
You appreciate Wyman's ability to stay with the pass. That was tipped. Come down with the reception.
Straight quarterback run, keeping the football. Childers, he tried to follow the blocks of his center, Luke Shively and Nathan Velos, the right guard, and moved those chains. Childers needed one, got about one and some change. First down, Northern Illinois.
Coach Carey has to be encouraged what he's seen out of his young quarterback, because when you're in a situation where 2 years in a row, you actually three, of having multiple quarterbacks, you may have found your future quarterback, because so far he's been very impressive in this
game.
Prior
to the snap, ball start, offense, number 89, 5-yard penalty, first down.
Mitchell Brinkman got hit. Now make no mistake too, this young man right here, Rod Carey, the head football coach of Northern Illinois, again in his fifth season, folks, you know, they went to three straight MAC championship games against Bowling Green. They went to six consecutive MAC championship games from 2010 to 2015. As on that check down on that horizontal route, that is dropped by a wide receiver, Spencer Tears. It'll bring up third and long. But Gerard, the point is of this, make no mistake, Rod Carey told us this week, they were bitterly, bitterly disappointed about a 5-7 last year. What did Rod Carey tell us? That's not what we are at Northern Illinois. And every man, coach, player, had to make a commitment that that would never happen again.
Yeah, expectations are high with the program, and it's been stellar. And as you see with the defense.
Back to the ground game, and Tommy Mister will break that on a second and 15. Mister got nine of that back. It'll bring up third and six now on a Bowling Green 33.
Mister showing patience, yet also the ability to run through arm tackles. You're not going to bring him down by sticking your arm out there. You have to do a much better job of shedding the offensive lineman and making a heads-up play on the runner.
Well, this Bowling Green crowd now coming up here on a day they salute the 1992 BG squad. Straight quarterback draw. Childers came up about a yard shy of that first down. And making that stop again is Aaron Banks. Banks wears number 11. He's made playing a lot. He's normally behind Armani Posey. But we haven't seen a lot of Posey today. As it's Aaron Banks, the 240-pound fifth-year senior, that has been very active and in on a lot of hits. There's a good look at Aaron Banks. Fourth down and a long one. Mister on the carry. Never got touched and got enough to move those chains for a first down as he stumbled his way in that hole. Hey, how about number 73, the 330-pound left tackle, Max Sharping, the Outland Trophy candidate.
Yeah, Sharping did an excellent job of sealing the edge right there. Had it not been for the turf monster, Mister's probably still run to the end zone. Nothing worse than a turf monster bringing you down when you have opportunity to pick up a big play. But also what I'm seeing, Michael, is great success on the part of Northern Illinois with the misdirection plays.
Now Mike Jinks and his defensive coordinator, Perry Iliano, want to think right here, it's just a matter of, all right, let's try to slow this Northern Illinois pace and tempo down a little bit.
Certainly, because right now they're marching down the football field on you. So you say to yourself, give my defense a chance to recover, gather their whereabouts, and get an understanding of what's hanging in the balance right here, because you don't want to be in a 21-7 situation or even 17 at this point.
Yeah, quite frankly, 2 weeks ago today, and I, Gerard and I looked at each other when we heard the final, 2 weeks ago today. We were calling Akron's win over Ball State, and we heard that Bowling Green went into Miami and beat the Miami Redhawks. Ohio was in here, Frank Solich's terrific football team. And Bowling Green couldn't capitalize on that win at Miami. They got beat 46-30 last week, but Mike Jinks, we're feeling better where we are.
And throughout the course of this game, you've seen where the frustration lies in that you've had your opportunity and chances. It's just poor decision-making on the part of your quarterback has hurt you so far.
Well, speaking of decision-making, how about Marcus Childers there initially, Gerard? He was looking to make that throw on the wheel route as Childers was moving around. They picked up another first down, but he was looking on that wheel route initially to hit Marcus Jones. Jones uncovered and came back to him, made the catch.
And the level of composure that he's showing and that he didn't force the issue. The wheel route was not there, so what did he do? He went to his third and fourth reads.
Just went to a second read there. He's got the touchdown throw as Marcus Childers from 15 yards out. Childers throwing the strike as he was able to wait till things came free there. Now you take a look at this. As Childers was right on time as he was able to gun it to Spencer Tears for the touchdown.
And this is what we call take what the defense is going to give you. If you're going to give up the inside route, I'm going to beat you all day on the inside. It is imperative as a cornerback safety that you protect the inside and not give the quarterback and receiver the easiest throw there is to make in college football, which is in the middle of the football field. You have to take away the inside. And right there, if you get turned around like that, you'll get beat all day, every day.
Christian Hagan with a PAT. There's your touchdown maker and the young man who threw it. Marcus Childers connecting with Spencer Tears. Childers to Tears, 21-7 Northern Illinois. Solid performance from that young man, a redshirt freshman out of the state of Georgia, Marcus Childers. He threw that TD shot, his second of the day, 113 yards in the afternoon. Gerard, what did you talk about pre-snap reads? What did he read here with Spencer Tears working on Clint Stevens?
What he simply saw was that Clint Stevens is trying to take away everything, and you can't take away everything. You can't take away the deep out as well as the inside cut. And in this particular situation, there is no safety help, so you have to take away the inside. That's what the defense is designed for, and by committing to trying to play the out and worried about that, he got beat inside, hence the touchdown.
Gerard, we saw Clint Stevens is a real good corner.
Yes.
But crossed his legs and turned his back there.
And the rationale in his mind, because I've been there, is I don't want to get beat on the out, but guess what? The defense designed for you to make a competitive play on the out, but protect the inside.
You think the possibility was, too, that he felt maybe he had safety help over the top on that inside shoulder?
Well, no, because he had no help. That was just man-on-man all by yourself and you have to, again, take away something. In that case, he took away nothing.
Gotcha. Okay. 21-7, Northern Illinois as quarterback Marcus Childers has been sharp today, this young man from Adairsville, Georgia. And now, you know, we just talked about pre-snap reads and understanding defense, and we have got a quarterback change for Bowling Green as Grant Loy, the number three quarterback, takes over. Gerard, we got to discuss this as that first down carry is from the True Frost, the sensational Andrew Clare. Is this a teaching moment from head coach Mike Jinks for everything we spoke of the last series?
It certainly is, because you can't have a situation where on multiple occasions you go out and put your offense and defense in peril because you're making poor decisions.
So we'll see if James Morgan is going to get back in. Loy with that quick toss. And this is Andrew Clare. Look at the freshman stay alive. You got to love his vision, his shiftiness. And he's got a first down, 20 yards on that carry from Andrew Clare.
And Clare is simply sensational. Watch his ability to, again, get outside, then make defenders miss, and then show you that I have power to run as well as balance. Very impressed with his ability to run the football.
Again, this is a terrific tackling secondary, and he left that all-Mac outside linebacker, Jawan Johnson, in his wake with that quick juke. That was
I like that.
From a running back or a wide receiver.
And it was exactly.
This is second and nine. Having fun here at Doit Perry Stadium. Why not today? College football, the best in the business. Now, the first carry of the afternoon, Gerard, for Donovan Wilson, the number three running back, fifth-year senior out of Dublin, Ohio, Jerome High School down in the Columbus area.
That's what we call the power back. Great size. Well, it's 6 feet, 225.
Yeah, Grant Loy, speaking of the Columbus area, New Washington, Ohio. He's a redshirt freshman. He's a number three quarterback. Jarrett Dakey is the backup. Loy will gun that shallow cross. And that's hauled in. Loy just got about seven on that throw as making that catch for Loy Bowling Green, Matthew Wilcox.
But there's some, Morgan should be encouraged by this, in that simple looking off of the safety and not staring down on receivers will help his game tremendously, because that's essentially what he's doing, Michael, is just making poor mechanical decisions as far as not the issue of throwing the football, but we're talking about Morgan. In that, and he's probably explaining to Loy, good job here, but Morgan, if he can just get the whole idea and concept of looking defenders off in the secondary, he'll do a much better job.
The Ray Guy Award nominee, look at Joseph Davidson, just hit another howitzer. How did he get that to turn over and go horizontally sideways inside the five? Folks, keep a picture of him in your mind. You're looking at a future NFL punter. He might be the best in America. True stuff.
And when you're able to routinely pin down an offense because of your ability to flip the field and put enough touch on it so where it has that bounce to where your coverage team can make plays, you are so correct in your assessment that he'll have more than opportunity on Sundays. That type of stuff will get you in the Hall of Fame because it's a field position game. And he's been a very, very intricate part, though a punter, in helping keep this game in the balance.
Gerard, how about this, too, for Joseph Davidson? He's 6'7", 240 pounds. That's one big punter now, as Tommy Mister has got that first down carry, of course, out of the zone read concept.
Think about that. Had he not had these pin back situations, this game is more than likely out of reach. Now, granted, they're down by 14 right now, but that could easily be 28.
Yeah. They flip field positioning. And, of course, remember, after he pinned Northern Illinois back at their own one in the first quarter, after the punt exchange, Bowling Green started the drive at Northern Illinois' 39-yard line. Now, can they do the same here? With 4:30 left in the first half. Stay with the ground game and stay with Tommy Mister. And Mister will bang his way for a first down. So Mister with a couple of carries, and that's going to move the chains. And again, I got to tell you, Jordan Huff, for all of you Northern Illinois fans, the lead running back on this squad, the fifth-year senior, who's our leading rusher with 450 yards, banged up, ankle, lower leg, didn't make the trip today, not in this football game.
To Mister's credit, he's done a great job filling in.
Third straight carry, Tommy Mister, as he follows the blocks of his center, Luke Shively, and left guard, Jordan Steckler.
And Mister's been able to maintain his special teams duties as well. Just watch Mister's patience as a runner. Diagnoses where the openings are and then hits the hole, and that's what you want, straight ahead running, north and south, that's the key. No dodging in the backfield, but going straight ahead.
Well, Mister got nine. Marcus Jones is going to give him a respite now. Now they emptied out, though.
It's a team sport, but I'm pretty sure it helps. Like, I better get back on the field soon because Mister's looking really good.
The check down, finding tight end, and one of the best of the biz, Shane Wyman, but Wyman couldn't get started. Bowling Green read that beautifully and knocked Wyman down. Is coming up to make that hit for the Falcons out of their secondary, Marcus Milton. There's Marcus, the free safety.
Yeah, Milton provides for us an example of how you stay home and read your read. And if your job is to stay on Wyman, you stay with him and you make those type of plays.
Boy, it's so easy to get caught peeking, right?
Yes.
For a DB, Gerard, in that backfield. I'll go back to the ground game. A strong hit as Bowling Green's Clint Stevens upended Marcus Jones. So Jones now, he's the backup today to Tommy Mister. Now, normally the pecking order for the Northern Illinois running back room goes Jordan Huff and Tommy Mister and then Mark. But without Huff today, step up.
Yeah, by
committee.
Here's
your chance.
Nothing wrong with committee. And I always say, never let them see your backup. And today the backups have been very effective.
Now, Childers taking a shot to see Beebe with a move. This is Chad Beebe. Beebe, time to accelerate inside the five. Touchdown, Chad Beebe, Northern Illinois.
And beside the impressive run after catch, it's Beebe's ability to go back across his body to haul it in to keep his balance and run down the football field for the score.
Just like his daddy. I got Gerard. Can't you see Don Beebe?
And this is how you make your quarterback look good, because that should have been an interception. But because Beebe's inability to reach back and keep his concentration and have those glue-like hands, he hauls it in and goes in for the score. Because that should have been an interception because the ball was behind Beebe.
Partner, great, great pickup by you to emphasize the ability to snatch, pluck the football, catching it with your hands. Perfectly described by you. Extra point converted, of course, by Christian Hagen. And, again, everything else. But Gerard, take us through it again with the snatch by Beebe.
You see, and Beebe's running the crossing route or deep slant. But right here where the ball is behind him, slows down, he grabs it and plucks it because that's going right to the safety. But what's more impressive is that he's coming across the body, but he finds his balance and then the ability to run away from the defender and also understand the angles that, hey, this guy is going to catch me. Let me change my angle so I can get in the end zone. Very headsy play on the part of Beebe, and yes, he is making his father very proud.
That's the fourth catch of the afternoon. Fifth-year senior, Aurora Christian High School, Aurora, Illinois. And well, for Chad Beebe, though, that's the first touchdown catch of the year. Gerard, remember a year ago and for the last 4 years, Kenny Golladay was the 6'4" wideout. It was a third-round draft pick. There's already some strong things with the Detroit Lions working with Matthew Stafford. Golladay was the guy on this, Northern Illinois pass-receiving crew. But so he graduates and moves on. It opens up for the likes of Beebe and Christian Blake, and these kids have responded.
Right, and Northern Illinois puts out receivers. I think about Tommy Lee as well.
Yes.
And what he's been able to do in the pro game.
You're absolutely right. Tommy Lee Lewis, Jawan Breskison, right?
Yes.
We love all the NFL guys.
Right.
Now Golladay. And maybe Chad Beebe.
I tell you, Beebe keeps on playing like that. There are plenty of places that will appreciate a receiver's ability to, one, read defenses, be your sure-handed receiver, and find those spots in the zone and understand the concept of option routes and being on the same page with his quarterback, but also bailing out his quarterback. Because on that play, he bailed out Childers, because that should have been behind the back interception going the other way. But instead, it resulted in a touchdown because of his exceptional play.
Head coach Mike Jinks of Bowling Green, he's going to stay with Grant Loy and going to keep it on the ground. And Bowling Green now, after that pitch and catch from Marcus Childers to Chad Beebe that put the six on the board, has now resulted. This would be a Northern Illinois up 28-7. You just got a good look there as well. As you know, this defense, sensational. Juwan Johnson, one of the ringleaders of it. So instinctive, said his head coach, Rod Carey. Gerard, going back to that catch, and again, we know they're down young men so talented, marvelous receivers in this game, but as you so astutely pointed out, that catch, think about it, you know, you're running full bore, running that dig, you're coming back across your body. I'm not sure that 50% of the, even the talented, gifted receivers that we see every week in this game could have made that catch.
Right, and that's the athletic part that's so pronounced with BB, in that he has the ability to go crossbody, expose himself, haul it in, and the level of concentration that goes along with that cannot be said enough of how impressive of a play that is to then keep your balance and go
take
for
it
the
to
score.
The house. Yeah. So 28-7 Bowling Green in a 3-touchdown hole with 2:14 left. Loy being flushed. Now gonna gun sideline, and that's hauled in. Well, Loy made a play there. He kept it alive and was able to find wide receiver Datron Guyton, the big fella at 6'5". Stopped the clock momentarily, moved the sticks, first down Bowling Green. Wow, do they need seven here.
In a major way. And Loy does an excellent job of avoiding the pressure because it was certainly applied.
Go back to the ground game and run the big fella, Donovan Wilson, at 230 pounds. Move those chains again. 15 yards for Wilson on the first. Oh, wait a minute. We've got a flag in Bowling Green's offensive backfield, and we're going to have to hear from referee Tim O'Day. Going to come back.
Holding. Offense, number 78. 10-yard penalty, first down.
Momentum killer.
Yeah, it is that, and you know that Clark Clancy, the fifth-year senior out of Troy, Michigan, feels very badly about it, right. But he got caught.
Yeah, and I'm indifferent on that, Michael. I thought he did an excellent job of pulling it, but the defender is going to turn his back to you to try to shed a block. That's not his fault. I'm not trying to critique the referees,
no,
but sometimes
sure.
You have to let things go because that's a very subjective call right there.
Understood. Understood. Clark Clancy, he'll be physical. He usually backs up Lorenzo Tabor. He'll stay with the ground game. Look at Donovan Wilson run hard against one of the top 15 FBS defenses in the country as Wilson ultimately got knocked down. He got seven, though. And making that stop was Jalen Embry, a backup corner out of Martin Luther King High School in Detroit. Parentally strong program. Loy, that got deflected, and it got picked off. The third interception of the afternoon. Football got deflected, and making that pick for Northern Illinois, Michael Allen, the strong safety.
Yeah, on that play, though, Loy has no reason to hold his head down. If the ball gets deflected, you'll take that over just a poor decision-making or poor mechanics. And give credit to Northern Illinois for being in the right place at the right time and making this play. Right there, that's what you call for your defense to do. And who made the play? Sutton Smith. He's a very active defensive lineman. If he's not applying pressure, he's doing things like that to make him a very special defender in batting that play. That was completely set up by his ability to be dimensional in his attack as a defender.
Partner, you and I as defensive guys, how about this? Third interception on the day, 13th INT for this ball hockey Northern Illinois defense on the year. As Marcus Childers will settle for a 2-yard gain after that sudden change turnover. How about Northern Illinois' win in Lincoln, Nebraska on week 3 of the year? 21-17, they
right.
Beat Nebraska. Two pick sixes against Tanner Lee that got him the lead, and then defensively they held on to win it.
Yeah, and best believe that amazing pass rush that they applied played a part in that.
Guess who? Chad Beebe making the grab. He was running free in that seam. That's a first down. Good for 17 yards. It'll move the chains. First down, Northern Illinois. 45 ticks left. They want more points.
And a classic example of throw the ball where the defenders are not located.
Quick toss to Tommy Mister, and Mister got upended and knocked out of bounds, but it's going to stop the clock for a moment. Did we get a late flag there that came flying? It was just a timeout. Yeah, simply a timeout.
30-second team timeout. Please reset the game clock to 35 seconds. 35, please.
Keep it right here. Now, it's pretty obvious, if you remember, before the pick. Remember after a couple of first downs from Bowling Green? Rod Carey called timeout.
Right.
So he said, you know right there. Whoa, boys, we want to get the football back and try to put more points on the board here.
Right, apply the pressure. And you're saying, heck, we got to make up for what did not take place in the second half of last week. So if you are Coach Carey, you have to be very impressed with the offensive output you've seen so far, the decision-making out of your young quarterback, and also the ability for your other running backs to fill in with Huff being sidelined due to injury.
Well, and Raj, you look at Rod Carey again, just sensational. As I mentioned to you a little bit earlier, 34 games against MAC competition, Rod Carey is coach. He's 28-6, 183% of them. Now off play action. Childers is going to take a shot. And that was broken up beautifully as Childers was looking to find wide receiver Matthew Wilcox. Or let's check that. It was Wilcox. It was broken up, though, as Bowling Green's secondary was able to break that up, as that was Montre Gregory, who's had a good first half.
Right, and that's what we call being greedy on the part of Childers, because there's no reason to throw this football because your receiver's well covered, and on top of that, the ball placement is in the wrong spot. That has to be on the outside shoulder as opposed to the inside.
Yeah, I was looking for leading receiver Christian Blake. BB on that underneath throw as they worked that crossing route underneath, and BB made the catch. Six catches for Chad BB in the first half. Came into today, Gerard, with 11 on the year. He's caught six today in the big one for the quick Northern Illinois TD.
And at some point, Bowling Green's going to have to make an emphasis in an effort to cover BB because he's running free just about every time he catches the football.
Now for the 28-yard line. Childers again. Horizontal short crossing route. Christian Blake made the grab. Stepped out of bounds. Give them about five. But more importantly, they are definitely now in field goal range for Christian Hagan. Right from here, Gerard, it'd be a 41-yarder. They have probably two more plays if they want it.
It's a key part if they want it.
Second and six. Childers going to take a shot. Corner of the end zone. He wanted BB again. Well, this time, though, Bowling Green had BB bracketed in double coverage. Montre Gregory and Marcus Milton on the double coverage of BB.
Yeah, and that's a proven right there on how you actually play a sound defense. You're in a cover four situation. As a cornerback, you have someone drop in front of you. Best believe that there'll be someone coming behind.
Partner cover four. That is
quarter.
Nobody explains it better than my man Gerard Cherry, a longtime nine-year NFL veteran in the secondary. And oh, by the way, three-time Super Bowl winner with the New England Patriots. Proud of you for that, man.
Right place, right time.
Third down and six. Childers, a lot of real estate. He's got a first down. That's going to stop the clock. Northern Illinois got a timeout if they want it. Might take it or might get a quick spike. I think Rod Carey's signaling, let's get the timeout here and get the field goal team out. We'll see. Now how about Rod Carey? Sorry, let go ahead and run a couple more seconds off.
I respect that. You may not want Clitter to get an opportunity to have a kickoff return.
That's what and Rod Carey is over there telling the referee Tommy Davis, looking at him, expecting him. You're fine. Go ahead. Then we'll call.
Yeah, but that's being a student in the game, recognizing that on the opposite side, though you may be up a lot, you have a playmaker in Clitter that could do just that. You kick it off to him, he's shown flashes of brilliance today. He is more than capable of taking it back to the house.
Rod Carey and his coaches, Mike Yuremovich, the offensive coordinator and defensive coordinator, Kevin Kane, as we talked to them this week. Gerard, we could sense this. Wait a minute. You asked Mike Jinks about, you put the tape on and they see a team that's only won one football. He said all I had to do was what? Put that tape in.
Right, exactly. Right? That's what Coach Carey had to say. He said, yes, they may not have a record that bodes well for the year, but what you do see on tape is that they're a play or two away, and you've seen that on display today. Just a few decisions made better on the part of quarterback play, and you have a different football game.
Final play of the first half, 29-yard field goal hit straight and through, splitting the sticks. 29-yard make from Christian Hagan. That'll put the final snap of the first half in the books. And the Huskies of Northern Illinois trying to go to 3-0 in the MAC. Well, I got to feel good about that 30 minutes. Halftime. And our Capital One halftime report is next. 31-7, Northern Illinois over Bowling Green. Don't go anywhere. Gerard Niles starts you through what will prove to be a compelling halftime experience for you. That's next as Northern Illinois has opened up a 24-point lead on Bowling Green.
Welcome to the Capital One Halftime Report.
We do indeed welcome you to our Capital One Halftime Report. What a first half of the college football season. Let's take a look at all the electrifying moments from just that.
There's no sure things in college football.
Iowa State knocked off Oklahoma.
Historic numbers in terms of upset.
Number two Clemson.
It's the beauty of college football.
You write about how good we are, like rat poison.
Give nothing and take everything. All we have to do is stick together. That's right.
It's gonna be gone! It's a touchdown!
It was 44-10. Comeback complete!
Penn State wins it. A walk-off touchdown. Wow!
This is what I love about college football, is the uncertainty.
Welcome to the Capital One Halftime Report.
Doug Perry Stadium today has been, it's been dominated by the Northern Illinois defense, and that's no surprise as this Husky squad looking to stay perfect in the MAC West at 3-0 with a 31-7 lead. Michael Reguy, Gerard Cherry. We came on the air letting you know and billing this Northern Illinois defense as one of the finest aggressive ball hawking in the nation. Gerard, they didn't disappoint. Three picks in the first half. It started with the first of the two off Bowling Green's quarterback James Morgan by Treshawn Foster.
Right, and the issue with the interceptions was simply an attitude and technique, because if you're Morgan, you have to do a better job of, one, trusting your receivers, and also at the same time understanding that you have to look safeties off and you can't stare down your receivers. And if you do that, that's what's going to take place, interceptions. And the same thing transpires right here, in that if you're staring your receiver down and if you're not throwing to the right spot, that's going to translate to an interception. Right here, you can't blame Lloyd. It's a tip ball because of the great playmaking ability of Sutton to apply that pressure and tip that ball, resulting in that interception.
13 interceptions on the year for one of his terrific defenses. And now that throwback off play action to Shane Wyman.
Yeah, and that is a beautiful play by design and great execution on the part of Wyman to, one, hold his block and then have a sense of presence to catch the pass. And then you look right here. That's how you fit a ball into a tight window, as Tears comes down with reception with the DB's inability to protect the inside. And you should celebrate if you're Childers with that type of a throw, because it was a tight window. And then right here, Childers is bailed out by his receiver, Beebe, who goes across the body, plucks it out of the air, and then has the ability to go to the house for the score.
If Beebe doesn't snatch that throw behind him, I think Marcus Milton might have a pick six going the other way. But this is the destructive nature of the Northern Illinois defense and how they can start to take over and then dominate a football game.
Yeah, and that is the luxury of having a pass rush in which you don't have to rely on blitzing, and you can put guys in the secondary because you're applying the pressure with your front four.
Yep, and Bowling Green's got to find some answers. There's
they
no doubt about
do.
That. We'll see Mike Jinks change quarterbacks from his starter, James Morgan, to the number three, and his quarterback room and Grant Loy. We'll see what the second half brings. 31-7, Northern Illinois. Capital One Halftime Report will roll on after this timeout.
Welcome to the Capital One Halftime Report.
Indeed, we do welcome you to our Capital One Halftime Report. Hey, hoping you've been a part of the fan vote all year long. You might see some impact plays in this one that you could vote on Tuesday, and you could see them next week. Let's take a look.
Quite a scene here in State College.
It's a hostile environment.
You see 107,000 in white shirts. It can be a little disconcerting.
How do you tackle a guy that can squat 650 pounds?
Saquon Barkley, here he goes. Save, gone!
Let's see, he runs it, he catches it, he returns it, and he passes it.
He is the complete package.
Tennessee's kind of been reborn. As you look at that super hard nose and two-charge, matching out football, you know.
The 50-50 ball is won by Penn State.
Penn State defense, best in the conference on the season.
Make sure you vote by Tuesday and quite possibly at ESPN.com, and you might be able to see some of these plays next weekend, like Saquon Barkley and Penn State. More coming up. Don't go away.
Larry, you got to get those burgers off the grill.
Doug Flutie? Through the Hail Larry?
You mean a Hail Mary?
Tomato, potato, man.
Those are two different words.
Let's go, Dr. Pepper, hip! Let's go!
Well, let's take a look at a Dr. Pepper campus moment. We alluded to this in the first half today. Gary Blackney, one of the finest head coaches in Bowling Green football history. That's Coach Blackney, and his 1992, there's Coach Blackney right there, that distinguished silver-haired gentleman, and all of his 1992 Bowling Green Falcons championship football team. Gerard, they were the best in the MAC for a couple years running in the early 90s, and head coach Gary Blackney was a terrific leader of that football program.
And you can still see the rapport 25 years later of guys coming up to their coach and paying their respect and homage to the fact that he did an exceptional job of leading this program in the early 90s.
Not a great thing about the game of college football that that we know. I mean, you never lose that feeling of being with the teammates and all that went into that. First half numbers, you see it dominated by Northern Illinois, almost 400 yards of total low. But again, their defense, one of the best in the country. Three big turnovers to give that offense the football right back.
Right, and it was a perfect example of complementary football on the defensive side of things.
All right, Bowling Green will get their hands on the football to start this second half. That's one of those non-returnable kickoff bombs that was driven through the end zone by Josh Orne. And let's see, who is head coach Mike Jinks going to send out to quarterback his football team to start the third quarter? He used to the starter James Morgan, and there's your answer, Grant Loy. We haven't seen the redshirt freshman as of yet, Jarrett Dagey. Dagey has been the backup and played a couple of starts before he was re-injured.
Well, if you're Loy, you're thinking right now, yes, I have a great opportunity. But one of the things you don't want to do is repeat the same mistakes you saw Morgan make, which is not looking off the safety and forcing the ball in bad situations due to poor location and decision-making.
That first snap is the ground game, and that's the sensational true freshman, Andrew Clare. So Clare got seven on first downs. How about this, Gerard, for Andrew Clare in that first half, four carries for 24 yards, and, of course, would have been a whole lot more than that if his own face mask didn't negate a lot of a 40-yard run.
Yeah, those numbers really don't speak to how dynamic he's been on today's game. And I would start half off as well, putting it into his hands, because the young man has definitely shown that he is a talent to be reckoned with.
Grant Loy is your quarterback. Looking to put it up. Pocket collapse. Guns that throw. Good ball that is hauled in for a first down. It'll be spotted around the 44-yard line. Boy, that's what you like, wide receivers that are going to get after it for you after catches. Janarvis Pugh, third time we've called his name today. Pugh with his making his fourth catch of the afternoon. First down, Bowling Green.
Yeah, and Coach Jinks has to be encouraged by that type of effort. That's what you want to see. You down by 24 points. How are you going to respond and react as a football team? Are you going to quit, or are you going to go out there and play with some compassion as well as composure? And that's what you got on that particular play.
Back to that zone read ground game and Andrew Clare on the first down carry. Again, if you're just joining us, you've missed a lot from this Northern Illinois nationally ranked defense led by Sutton Smith, who wears number 15, the defensive end who leads the FBS in both tackles for loss and quarterback sacks.
And one of the key things of being a dominant defensive end is what we call get off. And if you watch Sutton Smith, he gets off on the football, and that's a prime example right there, and that his ability to get to the backfield so quickly causes so much commotion and damage that plays like that take place.
That football's out. It's going to be a quick turnover, Bowling Green. Sutton Smith got pressure, but it was Josh Corcoran there who put that sting. We talked about Corcoran, the opposite defensive end. And coming in to come up with that quick turnover. That's a fourth turnover on the afternoon on Bowling Green.
And once again, they add to their total for tackles for loss and forcing fumbles and turnovers. You have to be impressed with this defense.
You know, Gerard, I had to look at it again. That might have been a safety blitz from Trayshawn Foster that came up with that hit. We'll look at it again. Nevertheless, turning the corner. And on that first down call is Tommy Mister. Let's take a look at that. Let's see if this is 11 coming on that safety blitz from the top of your screen.
And it was Trayshawn Foster, and he comes backside. And the reason why he's able to do that, watch how the pockets collapse due to the pass rush of Smith once again. And no need to use the blitz, but again, when they apply it, it's effective for Northern Illinois.
Yep, stay with that ground game on second and three. Probably going to come back on a hold as Tommy Mister picked up the first down, but I'm thinking that's going to get brought back.
Yeah, that's normally in the category of holding.
10 O'Day, you'll hear from him momentarily, the gentleman in the white hat heading this Mid-American Conference officiating crew today.
There are two fouls on the play. Holding, offense number 64. Holding, defense number 63. The foul's offset, second down.
Offsetting fouls, one each way, and that was, for Bowling Green, that was Gus Schwederman. Schwederman, the fifth-year senior, an outstanding player here. He got hit. And for Northern Illinois, it was the center, Luke Shively. So they offset. Let's replay second down. Second and three for Northern Illinois. There's that mesh point of the zone read. And this is Marcus Childers in open space at the 7-yard line. But we got another flag right around the line of scrimmage. Bowling Green thinks it's coming back on a hold.
And it certainly is. Another impressive run negated by holding.
Holding. Offense, number 65. 10-yard penalty. Second down.
Young right guard Nathan Velos. We've called his name a couple of times for throwing key blocks in the first half. He got caught there on a hold.
As you see, Childers is making the read option. He makes the correct read because there is no one there, and you see the hold right there. Watch the tail end of this play. This is what you call being a heads-up runner and recognizing that, hey, the guy's coming to strip the ball, so I'm going to switch hands. Little things like that mean so much in the game of football. It's those things I call the fine nuances of the game.
Yes, you do.
That have great impact on the outcome of plays as well as the game.
All right, it's going to set up second and 11 now. Zone read. And Childers throwing that skinny post. It was incomplete, intended for Spencer Tears. That previous play, though, that Childers had called back on what would have been a big run inside the 10. I mentioned mesh point and zone reads, Gerard. And when we speak of the mesh point with quarterback, and what's he reading? Is he reading defensive ends, the quarterback there?
Yes, as well as linebackers who may be blitzing and coming to his field of vision. And on that particular play, that's exactly what you got. So he made the prudent decision, which is to keep the football and go where they're not.
That mesh point, though, so important in offensive continuity in these zone read offenses. Childers trying to juke and dance his way and get beyond that line of scrimmage. He was able to do that. We'll see where they put him out of bounds. He got a couple. But it's going to bring up a fourth down, and Northern Illinois sending out the punt team here on their first drive of the third quarter.
Not a positive play, but a smart decision on the part of Childers in that, from our vantage point, we could see that no one was open. He didn't force the issue. He took what the defense gave him, which wasn't much. And now you're going to have a punting situation as opposed to forcing to a turnover.
Yeah, again, putting that tail of the football down. And look at the kickers today. Look at the kickers today. And is they going to put that down inside the one? Or are they going to say it was carried in the end zone, Gerard Jerry?
Now,
they're talking about it.
I would say end zone because it appeared to me that Jonathan Parker's foot was on the line. Wow.
That football is being put down just that close. I don't know, you tell me how many inches that is. How about the punters today? Both Joseph Davidson for Bowling Green and Matt Ferentz for Northern Illinois. Falcons football. Here we go.
All ESPN coverage is streaming live on the ESPN app. Download now and take ESPN everywhere.
Michael Rega, Gerard Cherry, and you here on ESPN as Northern Illinois is a 31-7 lead. All right, Gerard, this is under review, and let's take a look. Of course, they'll look at it from upstairs, and a punt defender cannot have any part of his anatomy on the goal line.
Seems pretty obvious. Clear and obvious that his anatomy, as you just described, that being his foot, was on the goal line.
Yeah, so that's probably going to come back. Now, right now, it was marked just inches away from the Bowling Green goal line. But we'll wait for the official.
There's been a rule change we're not aware of.
After reviewing the play, possession occurred when the ball was on the goal line. Therefore, by rule, it is a touchback. First and 10 at the 20-yard line, Bowling Green.
Yeah, good work. Our guys up here in the replay booth, they do such a fine job of the Mac. Our replay official, Jerry Brom, our communicator, Mac Aloisio, both of them said that was pretty obvious that, you know, that football's got to come out to the 20-yard line. Of course, terrific work by our camera crew here at Dwight Perry Stadium. Kudos, guys and gals. Well done. So Grant Loy will start from the 20-yard line. Sutton Smith leads it. Sutton Smith just took the football away. He's in the end zone. Touchdown. How many more ways are you going to impact a football game? Sutton Smith, incredible.
I've seen tackles for loss. I've seen batted passes that led to an interception. Now I've seen a tackle for loss lead to a touchdown because of the heads-up play to strip the football. As you see right here, Sutton Smith abuses his blocker. You can't put a tight end on him, but he has a presence of mind to say, you know what, if you're going to stand up, I'm going to take the football from you and go for the score. That is what you call heads-up, next-level football play on the part of Sutton Smith. This young man is playing at another level that no one is even close to him right now, Michael, and how he's going about this game of football and just being so dominant as a rusher.
Incredibly dynamic. I mean, like, wow, with an exclamation point behind it, folks. Well, Gerard and I just tried to point out, I mean, you're not going to see it this way. He came into this program as a running back, as Rod Carey was telling us the story this week, the head coach. Adding the PAT is Christian Hagen. And listen, hey, all of you producers and associate producers in Bristol, mark that one down now. That's gold star stuff from Sutton Smith. And oh, by the way, the leader in tackles for loss and sacks in the country. Gerard, so he had another TFL. He's going to get credit for that. Oh, that wasn't good enough for him.
No,
he's not satisfied with that. I'm going to take the rock away, too.
Exactly.
And then run to the house.
No, I'm going to take the rock away from you, strip you. I'm going to run down the football field. The amazing thing about it is you see the numbers here, 5 takeaways and 17 points off of that. That's going to get you beat all day for the Bowling Green. Coach Jinks can't be happy about that, but what are you going to do? Sutton Smith's just a special talent, and he's just playing above everyone else. during the 2017 campaign for Northern Illinois, and he is a major reason why they've been able to, again, change around the fate of their defense that struggled mightily last year.
Well, and, you know, this is a dynamic, this is an excellent true freshman right there, Andrew Player, folks. In fact, I was telling people about him just moments ago about how much we liked him. But there's his indoctrination to college football. Make sure you take care of the rock, or you got guys that are going to do those kind of things to you. As that Bowling Green return, and the return game is BG's Matthew Wilcox. So now it's a 38-7 football game, and the turnovers have been just destructive to Bowling Green from this Husky defense.
Right, you put an offensive defense right back on the football field. And what set that play up in the first place was a decision to block one-on-one with the tight end in Sutton Smith. That's going to get destroyed and eliminated every time.
Gerard, from a player's perspective, no, this is a young Bowling Green football team.
Yes.
And Mike Jinks has, in the last couple of seasons, his 2 years in offseason, he's had the top three recruiting classes in the MAC. But you're such a young football team like this. Where are they at emotionally right now? There's still 26 minutes to play. They're down 38-7, and they've turned it over five times. What kind of inner resolve do they need to show right now with pride?
One, that you don't quit and that you're going to still go out here and give an A effort. Though the scoreboard does not reflect well for you, that you still go out there and execute and get after Northern Illinois. Though they have the better hand as we speak, you still have to go out there with the mentality of, I'm going to still use this as an opportunity to grow as a player and make it about my team. Here you see again, Sutton Smith. And on the play again, so he's not satisfied. He's hungry, and that's what you want. A guy who has success like that but still has the wherewithal to continue to apply the pressure.
Second down 11, Smith in on that hit. Now Loy is going to look middle. Off the hands of Scotty Miller and incomplete. You know, back to Sutton Smith and why not. Sutton Smith is on pace, as we were discussing with Rod Carey and defensive coordinator Kevin Kane. Gerard, he is on pace, Sutton Smith, to break every existing Northern Illinois defensive single season record in both tackles for loss and sacks. Came into today with 20 tackles for loss, 12 and a half sacks. Not just the MAC folks, both those numbers lead the nation. And now he's got a tackle for loss with a quick touchdown run off it to go to his resume as well.
Something tells me he will be the MAC Defensive Player of the Week.
He's already been that three times this year. Now Loy with a pocket collapsing, working underneath and finding the sure-handed Scotty Miller, who made the catch. Miller on third down and 11. Going to come up about a yard and a half shy, and Bowling Green's going to send the punt team up.
And that's not the type of production you want, but when you have inexperience at the helm of the quarterback position, that's the type of results you're typically going to get. And you want at some point, where Coach Jinks have the wherewithal to actually go back with Morgan.
So Joseph Davidson, look at him. He just hit another howitzer. Look at how high in his hang time for Davidson. Fair caught by Chad Beebe at the 30-yard line. So just a normal, just another 47-yard bomb from Joseph Davidson. The venerable Doit Perry Stadium. This field has seen so many fantastic moments down through the years in the history of Bowling Green and Mid-American Conference football. Michael Rega, my partner Gerard Cherry, our producer Jeff Bentley, director Mark Isofano, doing a fabulous job. We appreciate all the hard work. And Northern Illinois is doing a fabulous job as well, as they've created five turnovers today and have built a 31-point lead. Marcus Childers going to throw that quick screen to start this possession after the 47-yard punt from Joseph Davidson. Christian Blake made that grab. Blake, the leading receiver, he and DJ Brown on the squad. But today it's been about Chad Beebe, Gerard.
Yeah, Chad has been sensational. His ability to, one, read the defenses and find those open spots, and then come down with the catch. Having a career day.
Tommy Mister on the carry out of that zone read ground game. And Bowling Green, and on that stop with Aaron Banks. It'd be first time, by the way, in his career he's been over the 100-yard mark for Chad Beebe. Just spectacular today.
Genetics is something, because if you put a Buffalo Bills uniform on him, you swear you're looking at a spot image of his father.
Yeah. Probably be just as productive here. This is third and one. Zone read. Why not? First down, Northern Illinois. Again, Tommy Mister's done a terrific job today, because we have to, for all of you that might be just joining us, a lot of you Husky fans say, well, wait a minute, where's Jordan Huff, our number one running back? Banged up, didn't make the trip today, and Tommy Mister and Marcus Jones and the receiving corps have made up for Huff's loss.
And the defense has contributed as well.
Just like this, Tommy Mister. That's 15 more yards. And, you know, Gerard, I mentioned it, you know, a moment ago, Bowling Green, there's 24 minutes left in this football game now. Pride on the line right now.
Yeah, and what you witnessed on that last play was a situation where no one wanted really no true parts of hitting Tommy Mister, and you have to play much better than that. There is a sense of pride that you have to have about yourself and how you approach this game, even in blowout conditions.
Marcus Jones, good move, and Marcus Jones has got 18 more yards to the down to the 20-yard line of Bowling Green. So now, you know, Gerard and I were discussing that they're going to go to that zone read game, and it's big. It's been big. It's still big.
And the telltale sign that you're a defeated football team, especially on the defensive side of things, is when a running back is not brought down, when he's running through arm tackles, because that shows that you're disinterested in actually applying what's needed from a sacrificial stance of your body to actually make these plays.
Red zone time, and Childers go take a look. Now he'll pull the football down. Marcus Childers looking for a block from Jones. There's a strong hit. Outstanding defensive hit as coming up from the corner to make that stop for Bowling Green. On that hit was Brandon Harris. Maybe the best of the bunch of this front seven for BG.
Right, and you can't accuse Brandon Harris of not laying the wood, because this is exactly how. If you want to run as a quarterback, you have to pay that price. And right there, Brandon makes Childers pay the price for running into the secondary.
Well, how about the red zone efficiency, Gerard? Northern Illinois came into today 25 of 30, 83%. Touchdowns on 60% of those. And have been 2 for 2 today. Childers, again, carried the football. And he got stopped by Malik Brown. This is going to bring up a third down and we'll call it 6. That line to make is down to the 11.
And at some point, you wonder if Coach Carey will want to preserve his quarterback and not go to a fourth one for the season, because if you're going to keep on letting him run those plays, they're going to line up and tee off on him.
Yeah, good call. Ryan Graham, the redshirt junior, started the year. Then Daniel Santa Canarita started 4. Pressure on Childers for the backside. He took a pretty good shot at the 15-yard line, so it's field goal team time now. This trip to the red zone not going to result in a touchdown more than likely, as Childers carried on 2 straight possessions there. I agree with you. I think maybe Rod Carey and Mikey Remmer is going to say Marcus. But let's give the football to the running backs.
And also in these points of games, not to say that Bowling Green will act in this manner and fashion, but when you get beat like this, a lot of times you start doing cheap things and taking cheap shots on players who've had a lot of success against you. You want to keep your quarterback and your playmakers out of harm's way and give your backup guys maybe the opportunity to have some action in these type of games.
A lot of leg from Christian Hagen. Hagen out of the hold of Josh Warren. Hagen's on the mark again. The lead is 41-7 for Northern Illinois. Northern Illinois Huskies, how impressive is this group of Husky dogs, shall we call them? And I say that with tremendous admiration. They didn't like last year, folks. They were 5-7. Now, they did go 5-3 in the MAG, but they went 0-4 in the non-conference. 5-7. Gerard, and this is on the heels of 6 consecutive MAC championship games. This was a program that said we got to get that real foul taste out of our mouths.
And the way in which they responded this year shows you that the expectations are high and players are willing to pay the price to match it.
Exactly, and they've come in. And I'll tell you what, in this day and age, and Gerard, you and I make no bones about it, we're defensive guys. And so, you know, it's something that we love to see. But in this day and age, well, let's be honest, playing defense in college football, It isn't easy anymore, folks, with all the rules and all the offensive philosophies that certainly are terrific, favor offensive football. This Northern Illinois group this year, they said, wait a minute. The defense took the responsibility. Reason we were 5-7, we didn't do our jobs last year. We're going to turn it around this year.
Exactly.
That they have.
And it starts up front. You say you win football games in the trenches, and that's exactly what Northern Illinois is doing. And what's so impressive, again, is the fact that they are relying on four-man pressures, because that shuts everything down. If you can get to the quarterback with four guys as opposed to relying on the blitz and zone dogs and things of that nature, then you have a great chance to do some special things on the defensive end. And that's what you saw on display so far today, in that Sutton Smith and company have been simply on fire.
Yeah, speaking of Sutton Smith, as you've been told, hey, big fella, we like what you – take the rest of the afternoon off, because he's certainly not in on this possession. And this is Grant Loy on that quarterback keep, and the Bowling Green QB has got a first down before toppled at the 42-yard line. So first down, move the sticks. And, you know, from this point on, I would think, Gerard, you look at small things, and Bowling Green could say, well, you always challenge your team. Let's put at least two touchdowns on the board.
Right.
Let's have two touchdown drives we put together here.
Make it look respectable. Because you don't want to get shut out in the second half. That does not look well when you see zeros on the scoreboard.
Andrew Clare, the true freshman on that call. He only got one to bring up second and nine. We're going to come inside the five-minute mark. And, again, let's remember now, after two turnovers, and Gerard, it's funny, Gerard and I were talking about it at the time with discussing it with all of you with where Mike Jinks was with the starting quarterback, James Morgan. Didn't see things and threw two ill-advised footballs that were picked, and Mike Jinks made the move.
Yes, and he stayed committed to the move. Now, the question is, what will he do next week? Will that be predicated on who has the better practice? But really, for Morgan, it's not as bad as it appears. Now, you can say he's been doing this for several weeks, but it's just a simple matter of.
Blitz coming from the outside there as Juwan Johnson was coming hard, and Loy's pass falls incomplete.
Yeah, but it's just a simple correct mechanics that I'm certain he's being taught. And just making sure you don't force the issue with your decision-making and ball location. Those are three things you can work on a daily basis, and you can definitely improve your ability to pass the football.
Well, and evidently the true freshman, Jared Dagey, the son of the assistant coach, Seth Dagey, who Mike Jinks brought in here. And Mike Jinks' background in the state of Texas, and we got premature movement there as Spencer Tears had about a 5-yard running start.
False start. Offense, number 14. 5-yard penalty, third down.
But Gerard, we can only assume Dagey got banged up. And let's check that. I said that of course, Janarvis Pugh.
Yeah, the right 14.
I apologize. Yes. Can't let that go, though, Jay. Got to be on top of it at all times. I stand accountable. But again, you know, Jared Dagey, the true freshman, has been the backup quarterback, started at Middle Tennessee, but got banged up. So I would assume he's not ready to go. We can only assume that. Andrew Clare is always ready to go. How about Andrew Clare? That's a true freshman with an outstanding run, folks, for Andrew Clare. That's 24 yards and a first down. He ran for 148, Gerard, last week against Ohio.
And watch the ability just to shift and to make those lateral movements to stay upright and get positive yards and still absorb the impact. He was going to be something special. You really have to be impressed with his ability to run the football. Protect the football definitely is an issue for him, but he'll learn that as he matures in the MAC.
Loy with a lot of pressure, and he exposed himself to a big shot. And he took that big shot as well from outside backer Bobby Jones. Well, Juwan Johnson and Bobby Jones, the two outside linebackers on this squad, Gerard, they are ball hawks and destructive.
Yeah. Once again, another tackle for loss, because this defense understands when you have your opportunities, you go out there and you get after the quarterback.
It's a 4-yard loss there as Jones put the hit on. Go back to the ground game and the zone read.
And when you have a situation when you have your backups come in and you see them still making positive defensive plays, that speaks well of the coaching staff and their ability to teach. Because that's the key part of being a successful football coach. It's not yelling at guys and demanding that you have success. It's right. about teaching guys how to actually play the game. And when you see the twos and the threes in there doing the same thing that the ones are doing, that speaks very well
tells
to the
you
future
all you
of the
need
program.
To know, right? Tells you all and about the program philosophy and how it's maintained, too.
Exactly. It's all about accountability.
Yeah. Terrence Stevens just got his first carry a moment ago. Sutton Smith is back on the football field. Loy made an excellent adjustment and fired that throw complete inside the 10-yard line to Pete Norris, a fifth-year senior who made the grab.
And Lloyd does a great job of staying alive and finding, again, the open receiver down the field.
Good job by Norris, too, yeah. Gerard. He doesn't see a lot of playing time. He's a fifth-year senior, came clean and made a play. Loy looking end zone. Loy in a lot of trouble, and he got taken down again as Loy was trying to make something happen in the end zone. There's just nothing there. How about that play by Trayshawn Foster? He's had a pick today, and he put a pretty good shot, looks like in the nose area, on quarterback Grant Loy, who's got to come off the football field.
Yeah, and I'm pretty sure Loy got hit with the face mask from his helmet because, again, the defender went up top. And we'll see right here. Loy scrambling around trying to make something happen, but here comes that pressure we spoke about all day. And as you jump into the receiver, right there you lose the helmet, and then you have, again, coming to the ground, face mask hits back on you. I busted my nose on several occasions
yeah.
with just that.
Oh, yeah, sure. Now, James Morgan now has got to come back on the football field now. So Morgan, the starting quarterback, has got to come back on the football field as Loy's got to come off for at least one play, and Mike Jinks and Bowling Green will call a timeout. On 2nd and 17. So you got to look at Grant Loy now. And, of course, Gerard, that's mandated. Anytime a helmet comes
right.
off, the player has to come off the field for a play, regardless of how the helmet. It could be just the chin strap came loose. Nobody was hit. But your helmet comes off during a play, and you got to come off for one.
Right. And that's for the safety of, obviously, the players involved. Because when you do lose your helmet or you have those type of plays take place where the face mask hits you, it's a painful experience.
Yeah,
you may
no
not
doubt.
Have all your whereabouts.
Yeah, Grant Loy, he's only a redshirt freshman. This is a very young Bowling Green football team, folks. And the way Mike Jinks recruits,
mm-hmm.
Gerard, and again, this is from me, and again, you know, you and I talked to every coaching staff around the country. The question is, how will Mike Jinks and his coaches be able to develop these young talents that he brings into the program? Morgan being flushed. Throw it at zone! And it was broken up. Broken up beautifully as a pair of number threes are going after one another. It was intended for Datron Guyton. Jalen Embry out of that secondary on the breakup. There's Embry.
Right. Embry obviously won this matchup. And what you like is that he did not force the issue. He timed it perfectly, got his ball, his hands in that window where Guyton was trying to bring the ball to his body. That's how you break up a pass right there. Nice PBU on the part of the defender.
Third and goal now from the 17. Morgan going to take a shot. Corner of the end zone. Broken up again. It was incomplete. And Jalen Embry has got back-to-back pass breakups. That was intended for Derek Putathong.
Well, give Morgan credit. He definitely did not go in there being gun-shy. He definitely was aggressive on those plays. So not lacking confidence.
Yep. Jake Suter is going to come out. Now, Holding is the very dynamic punter at Joseph Davidson. They let Davidson raise up and throw the football, Gerard. Probably not the time when you're down 41-7. You're going to work on this field goal unit from 33 yards out. A lot of leg from Suter, and he hit it.
Yeah, if there's some way in which you could score punting, be a closer game. That young man has skills.
Yeah, Jake Suter. Suter has been real good. He's now 13 of 14 on the year, a cool 93%. 2:04 left in the third. Bowling Green's on the board for the first time since we back in half number one. 41-10, Northern Illinois. And so over these Huskies, Gerard, we look ahead again. I don't want to prematurely put this one in the win column for Northern Illinois, but I will say that, come about a half hour, 45 minutes from now, if it doesn't end up in a win for Northern Illinois, we got a real story on our hands.
Yes, we do.
Got to add a little levity, yeah. Right, partner?
I like to see the 32 unanswered points.
Yeah, right. That having been said now, so back home to Eastern Michigan, got a quick turnaround Thursday night.
And that may be one of the reasons why you've seen the guys out in the third quarter, even with the blowout, is that you do have a game that you have a quick turnaround. And give credit, because a lot of times when a team knows that they have a game on a Tuesday or a Thursday, they typically look ahead on the schedule and don't concentrate on the team at hand. And that has not been the case today for Northern Illinois.
But the big one that everybody is already talking about is come a couple of weeks from now, on November the 2nd, about 15 miles to the north.
Yes.
Right here on I-75, hard on I-75, here in Northern Ohio, into Toledo's Glass Bowl Stadium, when Northern Illinois and Toledo will go after it again, as Toledo continued on their pace today as they came up with a big offensive performance. No surprise, they beat Akron, handed the Zips their first MAC loss, Gerard, 48-21. Jason Candle in Toledo with a big win to stay right with Northern Illinois in the MAC West. That punt coming down in the hands of Jalen Embry of Northern Illinois. And Embry, the young man who broke up a couple of passes in the end zone, Embry's got a strong return. Going to start the Northern Illinois offense late third quarter from the 46-yard line.
Yeah, Embry making his presence felt in the secondary as well as in the return game.
Well, again, I'm not, and Rod Carey would probably say, Reg, I'm going to come up there and pound you if he heard me saying it. I've got a real good relationship with Coach, though. I think he understands. You know, we're doing a game on TV today. We got a talking points. One of them, though, Northern Illinois Toledo. What do you see with that matchup coming up in about 13 days from now? It probably two undefeateds in the MAC West. That one may go a long way to decide who goes to Ford Field in Detroit to represent the West in the MAC championship game.
Oh, for sure. But what I will say, if Northern Illinois can continue to get this level of offensive production to match the stellar play of their defense, I don't see how you beat them. And I understand that Toledo is one of the powerhouses in the MAC West as well. But
tremendous offense.
Yes, yeah, tremendous. But the question is, what will
kicking team only had three players on this one side of the kicker. The 5-yard penalty be added to the end of the run, first down.
See, there's some of the things we were talking about, right?
Right.
Young football team.
Yes, and I have to give credit to the official for spotting that. That's what you call studying your own playbook. But, yes, that's one of the elements that's frustrating, but it's part of being a young football team. You can't bail them out with his excuses. You have to be cognizant of the fact that you need to have a certain amount of players in certain situations as well. But back to Toledo versus Northern Illinois, I don't see how you get over this defense, because I'm of the opinion, yes, though it's an offensive game, defenses still win championships. And if you can control the trenches, and if you have a situation in place which Northern Illinois has the luxury of having, four guys applying this much pressure, having this much production, how do you stop that?
And again, I think you said it as you started there. Flags, whistles, that's going to stop for a motion. False start on Northern Illinois.
False start. Offense, number 89. 5-yard penalty. First down.
Young guys getting an opportunity to play here. And see, these are the things that we can tell you that got whistled on the backup tight end, Michael Brinkman. You know, Rod Carey, he's not going to stand for that stuff.
No, not at all.
Quit looking at the scoreboard and lock into what we do on first and 15. Childers will trigger the out, and that's hauled in. Got the initial 5 yards back, is making that catch for the Huskies of Northern Illinois. On that grab, on that quick out, was Andrew Parchment. But you're right, again, I'll say this, and listen, Toledo has got the type of football team. No surprise at all if the Toledo Rockets, you know, at home. And these two teams have had some classics. As Childers now just playing kick, pitch and catch, he hits Christian Blake, going to bring up third and short here late third quarter. But that, is Northern Illinois going to play offense like this now?
Right.
with one of the best defenses in the FBS? Look out now. They're going to be a load to beat.
That's my whole point, that if you have a defense and an offense to complement and your special teams is making plays as well, it's very hard to beat a football team playing with this level of success and productivity.
Marcus Jones will move those sticks. He's got the first down. Back to the ground game out of the zone read. No Jordan Huff today. Hasn't really mattered. Both Tommy Mister and Marcus Jones have picked up the run game slack for the Huskies.
Yeah, you love it when you have opportunity to have running back by committee and have your young guys get that experience, but more so an experience to actually come in and be productive in the process of filling spot duty for a very successful and productive running Huff in his own right.
At his first down call, and again, it's Marcus Jones, and he's got 8 on first down. This is just straight ISO power football now. Out of the zone read principle, yes, but it's just power game in the gym.
Exactly what it is. It's a test of Bowling Green's will. Are you going to do something to stop us? Because there's nothing fancy here. It's just a straight-out situation of, are you going to continue to fight for the rest of this game? Because they're not doing anything fancy. It's just a matter of effort and desire at this point for Bowling Green on the defensive end.
Last snap there, that Marcus Jones 8-yard carry. Let's go to the fourth quarter, everybody. Northern Illinois has this one in hand. Come on back, though. We still got some good things for you. Ah, that's why I love college football. Show off the physiques, young fellas.
Yeah, the future's bright for Bowling Green. Got three recruits right there.
And there you go. I bet you Mike Jinks has already got some tabs on them. This is coming back. Flags, whistles. False start, Northern Illinois in the first play of quarter
number
4.
False snap, false start, offense, number 73. 5-yard penalty, second down.
Michael Regga, Gerard Cherry with you as we start quarter number 4. Northern Illinois has done it in all three phases of the game today. Offense has been terrific behind Marcus Childers, their redshirt freshman quarterback. The defense, as advertised, Sutton Smith, the FBS leader in sacks and tackles for loss, has made one of the most amazing plays you're ever going to see. And I know you're going to see it all over ESPN's Sports Center and college football final tonight. So make sure you're locked in for that. Gerard, I'm going to get home and watch because I want to see Sutton Smith play again.
And we saw it live. That definitely mirrors a dun-dun-dun-dun because that was an exceptional play.
Unbelievable. Here's what we've done through 45 minutes and 4 seconds. Double digits in every quarter point-wise for Northern Illinois today. 17 points off the 5 turnovers. Northern Illinois without their number one running back, Jordan Huff, out with injury. Ran for 233 yards today.
Right, did not miss a beat. And when you have what we'll call a poor performance from an offensive scoring standpoint last week, and to come back with this type of performance, you have to be very proud of what has taken place thus far if you're Coach Carey.
Starting quarterback Marcus Childers still in there and throwing that underneath route, and Childers able to hook up with DJ Brown. DJ came in today with 22 catches on the year, but on this day, that's the first catch of the afternoon for DJ Brown. Excellent slot receiver.
Yeah, when you have BB playing the way in which he's playing, it's going to be hard to get Brown into the game because BB, another guy we have not talked enough about, has been exceptional today.
Yeah, Marcus Jones on the first down carry. So Bowling Green defensively still trying to play hard as making that stop for the BG Falcons from that linebacking spot. As that looked like it was Brian Sanders that made the hit. Yeah, it was. Our guys all over it. Camera guys doing a terrific job today identifying, picking up tacklers, guys who make key blocks. Childers firing for the end zone. Now, could get a flag there. Nope, not going to be a flag as Childers was looking to find DJ Brown that we just spoke of. And a lot of twos and threes, and by that, Gerard and I mean guys who are second and third on the depth chart. Torian Hampton, who is a third-teamer on the corner for Bowling Green, got credit for a pass break up there.
Yeah, he got his PBU, but one guy that's not a second or a third teamer is still out there, and you're probably saying to yourself, why is Childers still out there? But I got to imagine it's just to get that game experience because he still is, though a starter, still an inexperienced football player for the Huskies.
Real strong performance after he replaced Daniel Santa Catarina against Kent State. Childress got flushed, and look out. He got buried from the backside. Football is free. Bowling Green's on that football. On the roll to the end zone. That's Kyle Jr., the young man we've talked about. Kyle Jr. picking up the fumble, but the big pop from the Bowling Green defense that looked like it came from, what's that outside, Gerard? From that backside.
Yeah, you see right there, it was David Konowalski, and that's the second time we've called his name today. And that's one of the risks that you run when you have your quarterback in there and you have backup linemen, and in this case it wasn't a backup lineman, but when you run with your twos and your threes, you run the risk of getting your quarterback in a bad position. Credit EJ for making that play.
So Bowling Green gets that sudden change turnover, and now they're going to go back to the ground game. And Donovan Wilson, the big fella, the 230-pound 50-year senior on that carry. So it has been Gerard Andrew Clair, that true freshman. And yeah, he had the football taken away from him, but you know, he's run for 75 yards today, and now the bigger 50-year senior, Donovan Wilson, on the carry, and we're going to get this timeout here at a 2nd and 9 coming up.
Yeah, and going back to Clair, it would have been over 100 yards had one of those runs not been called back and other penalties throughout the day. And remember, the Northern Illinois is one of the better teams in the nation at defending the run, so that speaks very well of the talent that Clair possesses in that he's gone over 70-plus yards against his defense.
Well, there's no question
about
that.
While the starters were in.
Grant Loy, by the way, back at the quarterback spot. Remember, he had to come off the field for a play while James Morgan took the final couple of snaps in that field goal drive for the last time Bowling Green had it. So there's Loy. So he had the helmet dislodged as he took a pretty good shot during that last possession. Got hit by linebacker Bobby Jones. But we're coming inside, 13 minutes left. Northern Illinois established the lead at 14-7, and they built on it through the course of the afternoon. 3rd and 8 for Grant Loy. Checks down. Wilson didn't pull the football in. Attempted to do it with just the right hand, right arm.
It would have been a pretty catch, but sometimes you got to go to routine manner and just catch it with both.
Now on a 4th and 8 from the 35-yard line of Northern Illinois. Now Mike Jinks for a moment looked like he was going to go for it, but now he's going to get Jake Suter out. Now Jake Suter's got this kind of leg, folks. Folks, this is going to be a 52-yard field goal attempt for Jake Suter. He's 1-1 in the day. This is his first attempt of 50 or more on the year out of the hold of the punter, Joseph Davidson. Don't think he's got the leg on it. Came up short and wide to the right. So Suter from 52 not able to connect. A stop on downs with the missed field goal attempt for Northern Illinois. So Mike Jinks, as we said, you know, and Gerard, we said his background was, you know, in the high school ranks.
Yes.
At the Texas, as he was a head coach there. Part of the Texas Tech program.
Yeah, played with one of my former teammates, Coach Hansel.
Oh, is that right?
Yes, played with Cliff.
All right.
He was a backup in New England.
Yep.
Did not know he had the coaching prowess in him, but hey, he's done a good job at Texas Tech.
Is that right?
Knew he could dance.
Coach Hansel. that's is that what you guys called him back then?
No, we didn't call him that back then. He was just Cliff.
And you're talking, Gerard, speaking of Cliff Kingsbury, by the way. So we keep it all even. And now we got a quarterback change for head coach Rod Carey. As you're going to take a look at the young man who started 4 football games, one of the best quarterback names in college football, folks, Daniel Santa Catarina.
Yes, and the reason why Santa Catarina is in the game is because Childers got hit blindside. And you do not want that to take place when you have your quarterback playing at such a high level. So wise and astute, prudent move on the part of coach.
Santa Catarina, the young man, there he is, Geneva, Illinois. Started 4 football games at quarterback spot this year after they took Ryan Graham out. Well, this ground game, look at Northern Illinois. That's Trey Harbison, Harbison, a young man we haven't seen today. Harbison's got his first carry. Tell you about this 220. He's a redshirt freshman out of North Carolina. Again, I mean, Jordan Huff's the starter. He's not even here today.
Right.
Tommy Mister, Marcus Jones, Trey Harbison, they have all picked up the slack without Huff here.
Yes, by committee. And you wonder, had Huff been present, what it would look like. But there's been no slacking in the run game today. Between the quarterback play as well as the running game by committee, it's been successional. Sensational, that is.
And a Bowling Green defense trying to string out Trey Harbison as making that hit for Bowling Green. Not look like Darian Hutchins.
When you're in situations like this, when you're the second and third guys out there, what the coaches want to see is your effort. Because the scoreboard may say that you have no chance, you definitely want to go out there and, hey, put me in there, give me opportunity and chance. And there have been many other situations where guys have flashed in these situations and found themselves with playing time the following week.
Harbison again. Well, look at Trey Harbison running strong. 225 pounds. He's another baby, Gerard. What I say about that, I just mean he's a young player right in the football program. Redshirt freshman getting his first opportunity after redshirting last year.
Yeah, what you're witnessing right now is Bowling Green versus Northern Illinois in 2018-2019.
Yeah.
He's getting a preview of it.
Well, again, I said earlier, if you, I know all of you Mac fans, you're aware, this was the matchup at Ford Field in Detroit, three straight seasons in the Mac championship game. 2013, 14, 15, Bowling Green won two of the three. Won two of the three. Two of them decisively in their wins as Santa Cantarina is belted as he took that shot from our man Nate. Look at Nate Locke, Mike linebacker. I can imagine defensive coordinator Perry Eliano said, hey, Nate, he said, no, I'm not coming out of the football game. Yeah. I'm good.
Presence in the classroom and on the football field.
Yep. Hey, Nate, your fifth-year senior, we're going to let some other guy. No, I'm not coming off the football field, coach. Massillon High School, Gerard Cherry, Nate Locke, tradition-rich Massillon High School. Santa Cantarina's throw. Came up short as he was looking for his wide out there, Jalen Ember. Was that Christian Blake? And the throw came up short.
And Brandon Harris with the pressure, forcing the throw.
That's going to bring up fourth and four. That was the fourth down throw. That's right. Well, we missed one on the down box. So that fourth down throw will now give the football back, change of possession to Bowling Green. All right, 41-10, Northern Illinois. Come on back with us to Doyle Perry Stadium. Northern Illinois trying to stay perfect in the MAC and win their third MAC game in a row, and they're well on their way to doing that. After that Bowling Green defensive stop, change of possession, that's Donovan Wilson for the Falcons on the first down carry. And Grant Loy continues in at the quarterback spot. James Morgan started it. Actually, Morgan, you know, hit a couple of throws. He's looking like his reads were, and then Gerard, two interceptions happened, and Mike Jinks said, we need to talk about it.
Yeah, great point, Michael, because the intermediate routes were pristine. What he was doing. When it came to the issue of throwing it deep and not looking the safety off in the location and spots is where he's going to need to definitely improve in order to get his job back as a starter.
How about Scotty Miller? He made that grab. Well, I was watching Miller all the way there, Gerard. It's one of the top receivers in the MAC. He was first team Mid-American Conference, 165-pound junior. He came on the slot, showed block, hold, wheel route.
The art of deception. That's how you do it. Show one thing but give them something else. And give Lloyd credit for finding him wide open.
Scott Miller, one of the best you'll find. He and you are two of the best slot receivers in the FBS today. Chad Beebe, Northern Illinois, Scott Miller, Bowling Green.
And Beebe made an exclamation point with that today.
Loy going to keep the football out of the zone read to the 17-yard line. 16 yards on the carry, Loy, first down.
Yeah, and Loy saw something he liked because he took the ball literally away from his running back. He was trying to take it as well. As you see right here, Watch the determination and decisiveness of Loy on this run. He's like, I'm going to make something happen. And you like that type of play. He recognizes, here's my opportunity. Get into the rotation and make something happen. Take advantage of the opportunity.
Sure. A lot of the second and third teamers defensively on the football field now for Northern Illinois. On that carry is Terrence Stevens for Bowling Green. Stevens on that carry. So we haven't seen Josh Cleveland in a while. He's the starter, the senior.
And he started off the game with some issues as far as having that limp. But at the end of the day, based on what Claire was doing, you really didn't need his presence.
Terrence Stevens offset here with Grant Loy on a second and nine after Stevens got one. Loy, oh, pressure coming. Got out of it. Grant Loy to the 10-yard line. Got 6 yards. Didn't see anything there. Right read, pull the football down and run it.
Exactly, and don't force it into an ill-advised throw. Defense wants to give you positive yards by you running it as opposed to passing it. Take it all day.
Going to come inside. 7 minutes left in this one on this snap. Third down and three. So the line to make is right inside. The ball's just outside the 10, so about right around the 7-yard line here to keep this drive alive on third down. Loy kept the football. Going to be close. Depends on the spot. As he got taken down right around the 7. I think they're saying it's short, though. Came up short. Fourth down and less than a yard, and going to go with size here. As coming in the football game for Bowling Green is Leonard Scatabo, 265-pound backup tight end. He's carried it one time, and Donovan Wilson, too.
Yes, he has. Didn't have success when he did carry it. Needed a yard to pick up, and that pretty much set the tempo for the game, him not picking up that first down.
Loy going to keep the football. Well, he's got a battle for that. He got there, down near the 5-yard line. And in on that hit for Northern Illinois, making that stop for the Huskies.
As you see Scatabro making the block right here, but watch the second and third effort on the part of Loy. He's determined to get this first down. It's the type of effort that you want out of your quarterback and out the rest of your football team if you're going to have a chance.
Yep, and he's able to pick it up. First and goal now from the 5-yard line. As we said, a lot of the defensive players on the 2-deep and 3-deep making that stop. Corey Lersch was in on that last one. Loyal gunned that slant, and it was not held on to at the goal line. It's more looking like he could make that catch was Matthew Wilcox, wasn't able to haul it in.
And Matthew, you learn when you have your opportunities, make the most of them. That was a catchable football. Though difficult, it was catchable. That's the rule. If you can put your hands on it as a receiver,
sure,
you're a scholarship for a reason. Now, if he had a defensive back number, I would exonerate him.
Yeah, DBs once in a while, we know.
Don't
secure the rock when they have opportunities. Back to the zone read game with a true freshman, Andrew Clare, came back in. Got a couple down to the 3. Going to bring up third down and goal from right there. Well, this Bowling Green football team, Gerard, as we said, you know, they average about 21 points a game, so they picked it up, some. But, you know, we got to get our quarterback situation smoothed out.
You certainly do. And right now you're in a spot where you're going to have a quarterback controversy, so to speak, because Loy has done enough, in my opinion, to merit the look of being the quarterback next week based on what you got from Morgan today. At the same time, though, Michael, if you keep on giving up 36 points per game on the defensive side of things, you're going to have a hard time winning any football game.
No, and I understand. That was interesting there. I mean, Loy threw the fade, right? He threw the fade. We got a flag that on the play there.
Heard in the end zone. Therefore, by rule, the ball was
the Northern Illinois pass interference went on Jalen Embry as Loy was trying to find receiver Quentin Morris. And Embry went down to the turf after the contact, but Morris wasn't able to haul it in. Watch this. This is interesting, Gerard.
Yeah, you see Embry holding off, and he just slips. Situation losing your footing.
Back live, Grant Loy twisting, turning. He's in the end zone. Touchdown, Bowling Green. And he comes up with that left shoulder kind of slumping a little bit after, again, he twists and turns to take a hit and get in the end zone.
And you hope there's no type of dislocation or bruising, but you'll see right here. Makes the fake, but it's this effort right here. He turns, and then the dive part right there, and you land awkwardly on the shoulder. And I hope it's not a hyperextension because, again, the young man's done enough to merit playing next week, but he may be out.
Yeah, we'll have to see now about whether Grant Loy, assuming if Bowling Green gets the football back, that who will be the quarterback. Loy took a shot, although he toughed it out. Look at that. Took a hit at the three, took another hit at the goal line, got in the end zone. 41-17. Northern Illinois when we come back to finish it up. Grant Loy battled his way in the end zone from 3 yards out a moment ago. May have gotten injured on the play. We'll kind of keep tabs on Bowling Green's sideline. 41-17 as Northern Illinois got the hands team on now. They're maybe expecting. They've got seven within about now dropping one off. But we'll see if Mike Jinks decides to see if he can sneak an extra possession out of this, Gerard, by recovering an onside kick. Well, at least they got the minimum out of four on one side of the football here. Let's see. Nope, and Nick Fields is going to bang it away deep, and Northern Illinois will start from the 25-yard line. All right, let's get our last timeout in this one, and then we'll come back and finish it up. Northern Illinois in command when we return to Dwight Perry Stadium. Great sounds that we're hearing today from the Orange and Brown Legions, the Bowling Green Falcon marching band. Always do a terrific job. 41-17, Northern Illinois with the lead, and of course, working on the ground game is their first down call with Daniel Santa Cantarina at the quarterback spot. As on that carry here on that first down call, the fourth running back we've seen today is for Northern Illinois is Dwayne Milton. He's a 210-pounder out of Wheaton, Illinois. So Milton now getting an opportunity, Gerard.
Yeah. Get your chance. Never know. Make a flash. Here you go. Here's that flash I was telling you about.
Look at Milton with speed. Milton inside the 25-yard line on that big, big carry before he got tracked and pushed to the ground by Jerry McBride to back up free safety. So running backs in abundance for Northern Illinois.
Here's a sign of good coaching and a sign of being coachable in that you recognize the defenders are coming, so what do? You switch hands. And that means Jordan Lynch is doing his job. And we haven't had a chance,
that's right,
an opportunity to talk about it, but he is one of the coaches for this Northern Illinois coaching staff.
Yep, Milton with yet another carry, third in a row for Dwayne. Dwayne Milton, by the way, is 175-pound redshirt junior. And he is now close to that red zone. Three carries in a row for Milton. So four running backs today. Jordan Lynch, back in 2013, he led Northern Illinois to a regular season day. Remember, Gerard? They
yes.
got to the Orange Bowl behind Jordan Lynch, played Florida State.
He was in the running for the Heisman.
Yes, he was. Now the running backs coach. Milton again, four straight carry. Managed to skate his way down to around the 18-yard line. It's going to bring up third down, and we'll call it three. And we're inside 3 minutes left. By the way, speaking of 3 minutes left, up at Reinierson Stadium in Ypsilanti, big one in the MAC West, Western Michigan, Eastern Michigan, tied at 17 apiece. Western tried to bounce back from their loss last Sunday that was delayed from Saturday, lost to Akron, 14-13 at home.
Right, for Tina is so far in the season being very dominant, is having some issues. And if you're Western, you're saying to yourself, how do we get back on track? But give Eastern credit for applying the pressure today. Very gutsy football team.
Well, yeah, and they've lost four football games real tight. It's Trey Harbison. Harbison, there you see him off the football field. He just picked up the first down. He got that carry for Northern Illinois. And now the Daniel Santa Canarina and this Northern Illinois offense drive. They're just letting the play clock run down as long as they can without snapping the football as the clock's running, and we're coming up to the two-minute mark here in this one. Stay on the ground again with Dwayne Milton. Well, probably have a few more snaps. As we said, you know, Northern Illinois, they're not trying to press the issue here. They're letting the play clock after it's spotted run down.
And Coach Jinks is not calling the timeout.
No. Well, Santa Canarina here on 2nd and 7. They did line them up, you know, fairly normally in their tempo offense. Milton's going to get cut down as, again, coming up to make that stop by the secondary for Bowling Green is Torian Hampton. They're down in 5 here. So, Gerard, you know, Toledo with a big win over Akron today. Western Michigan, Eastern Michigan still to be decided. Northern Illinois is going to go to 3-0 in MAC play. MAC West going to be a lot of fun. Don't forget about the MAC East, too, right now. Yeah, Frank Solich in Ohio, kind of, you know, just says hanging around up around the top looking for another East Division crowd.
Yeah, and very competitive, like always, in both divisions, but it's a lot of parity taking place in the East for sure.
3rd down and 5. Run that jet sweep and run it into the house. Touchdown, Juwan Wesley, Northern Illinois. To the end zone, young man that doesn't get on the field a lot, see much playing time. That's his first rush of the football this year. Caught 6 passes, now he's in the end zone. Jet sweep touchdown for Juwan Wesley.
Yeah, what are you going to do if there's no one in the boundary, no one setting the edge? You'll take that all day. No defense that I'm aware of that calls for no one to protect the boundary in the sideline.
Yeah. This bottom line, this has been another big day of complimentary football for the Northern Illinois Huskies. And we'll keep it right here after this PAT is once again banged through today by Christian Hagen. So, Gerard, here's the deal. You know, we mentioned about how now in 30 – Rod Carey has coached 35 MAC games in his 5 years in Northern Illinois. With this win today, he's going to go to 29-6. You ready for this against the MAC East partner? Rod Carey is now against the MAC East division. 28 wins and 2 losses. And that encompasses, too, as well, Dave Doran, because it goes back to 2008. And now they have won. The Northern Illinois program against the MAC East has won 23 of their last 24 games against MAC East Division opponents. And that's the likes of Ohio and Miami and Bowling Green and Kent State and Buffalo.
It tells you a couple things. One, Coach Carey does an excellent job. And the second thing it tells me is that the rest of the MAC East prays that there'll never be a realignment as long as he's at the helm. Northern Illinois. Yeah.
Well, that's the kind of job that man has done. And, yeah, the ultimate respect for him. As we said, they had the 12-0 regular season with Jordan Lynch, first Heisman finalist in MAC history. Now Lynch is on his coaching staff. What did Carey tell us when we asked him about, do you think Lynch was going to be a coach? But he said, no, not really. He said, I knew he had the smarts. It's just that he wasn't sure that he wanted to go through the grind. Remember he said because he was never a GA, graduate assistant. Which most players, if they want to get into college coaching, right, that's your first step.
Right, and obviously being a former Heisman Trophy candidate as well as a premier player in the program, you may get that pass, but he didn't allow that to stop him from paying the price and doing the work, because that is a testing ground. It's on the pro level as well. Are you willing to be the guy that'll do the grunt work, cut up film, and also make flashcards and do all those type of things necessary to show that you really are serious about doing this job, because coaches don't get enough credit for how much work they actually put into it. And Coach Carey commented on it. 90% of your job is in the classroom and doing things that involve cutting up film, making plays and schemes, and not actually playing or practicing on the football field.
That's a very good point. Good to see Grant Loy, by the way, back at the football game. And so Loy is going to finish this one out after he took that hit. Loy going to keep that on the ground. And running the football is Bryson Denley, the first time we've seen him today with only 14 seconds left. Did you ever have thoughts at all about being a coach, getting to coaching, either college or pro, NFL?
Thought about it, but also understand the time commitment of what it takes to do it. And you really have to be willing to pay the price.
Yep.
16, 18-hour days are the regular. And these guys don't get enough credit for the amount of time they put into it.
Well, you're right, partner. Bryson Denley with the final carry of the football game. That's going to do it. As Rod Carey will come across to shake hands with Mike Jinks. This one is going to be put in the history books. And you can book it as a 48-17 Northern Illinois win. The Huskies continue to roll on, as they now have won three straight in MAC play, and Sutton Smith with one of the most phenomenal defensive plays we have seen all year punctuating this win today.
Yes, Sutton Smith gets my game ball, my MAC player of the week, and everything else. Heck, I'll even take as far as saying in the country, because the performance that he put on today was flat out phenomenal.
Gerard, good job, buddy. As always, appreciate it. We will get together again soon. Rod Carey's showing his football team how appreciative he is of their workmanlike business trip to Dwight Perry Stadium and a big 48-17 win of a bowling game. That's going to do it for us. Hope you enjoyed it. You can watch them all on our ESPN family of networks. Get that Watch ESPN app, and you're right at your mobile device away from everything around college football. 48-17, Northern Illinois beats Bowling Green. For producer Jeff Bentley, director Mark Isofano, all the crew, great job, everybody. For Gerard Cherry, I'm Michael Regai. See you next week, everybody. So long.